folks. Here we go. Hello and welcome to One Hero Series coming to you live from Shanghai, China. My name is Mitch Chilson, and alongside me is the former world champion, Misha Tate, and we are so excited to bring to you a jam-packed evening of martial arts action. We've got 11 bouts, and we've got some of the brightest prospects in China who have come to put on a show for you tonight, and it is going to be a jam-packed card. We've got kickboxing, and we've got mixed martial arts, but kicking us off first is Chai Xiong Xiong taking on Suken Jimatai in the strawweight division. This is going to be a good matchup between two very tough strawweights. Now, we have the global rule set on this one. That means it's 3 5-minute rounds. The bout is judged in its entirety, not round by round. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent. As John Lai, the referee, gets us underway.
No strikes along the spine. Don't grab the shorts. Don't grab the ropes. Touch gloves if you want. Back to your corners.
Sure.
All right. In the blue corner, coming out in the red, white, and blue shorts, we've got Tatsiken. And coming out in the red and black shorts, we've got Chai Xiong Xiong. Misha Tate alongside me here at One Hero Series. What do you think of these two gentlemen? How can the fans look forward to in this opening bout?
Well, I think both of them are very hungry, so I think we're going to see a good action-packed bout, but you never know. I mean, I think that's the exciting part about martial arts is we don't know exactly what we're going to see, right? That's why it's like opening a box of chocolates or something. Every time I sit down and watch an event, I feel like I'm just in for a night of surprises. That's part of the reason why I'm such a fan of this sport.
Referee John Lai calling for a little bit more action as the scramble ensues. We can see Kai Chong Chong getting nice and tight in that body lock, trying to take the back, picks up. Tatsiken sends him, trying to take him for a ride, but he doesn't quite have the positioning here as he tries to wrap around to the back, drags him down to the mat, and this is where he's going to have the advantage. He just come from a grappling background, and Tatsiken does come from a wrestling background, but we can kind of see a little bit different style from him here.
Yeah, I was really interested to see that Chai was so successful in those wrestling exchanges. I guess you look at the backgrounds and you wouldn't expect that Chai would want to engage in that kind of clinch work given the wrestling background of Tatsiken, but look here, you know, this is why it's mixed martial arts. You know, not every sport always directly translates. And now we have Chai on top, delivering a bit of ground and pound himself.
Improve your position.
Tatsikin, you can see he's stuck here in half guard. He has one leg that's kind of holding him right there in the position.
No,
so
holding.
You can see Chai, he's trying to push forward a little bit into this position, but he's actually very comfortable. What Tatsikin needs to do is he needs to try to scramble out of this, but he's flat to the mat there.
There we go, a nice explosion by Tatsikin. That's what he needs to do. Preferably not give up his back in the process, though. Good scrambles by these guys.
It's a very back and forth match, but you can see a little bit of the inexperience when Tatsikin's on his back. So maybe his wrestling background, again, wrestlers don't like to be on their back. They prefer to be on top. But Kai is very aggressive and at least initiating a lot of these grappling exchanges. He likes to punch right into the clinch and get tight with that as he lands a nice little overhand right there.
I noticed in some of those early exchanges, good knees on the breaks and whatnot. So Chai's definitely proving that he's very well-rounded. Good exchange.
You can see Tatsikin's very light on his feet, bouncing up and down. I don't know if that's nervous energy or that's just kind of his style. But Chai's pushing forward, trying to put his back up against the ropes there. He looks like he's a little bit tentative just to initiate in the striking because Tatsikin's landing when there's an ace, when there's striking exchanges do occur.
Now the referee telling him more action, and they oblige.
And they do every time. I think they're just a little bit hesitant. This is a big opportunity. There's so much at stake for these young prospects, the chance to catapult themselves into superstardom by getting into, you know, the one championship elite roster. So it's definitely something that all these guys look forward to getting their hands on.
I do appreciate when a referee will dictate and push the pace, you know. These guys have such a tremendous skill set, and you just love to see when they actually get those punches off and get those kicks and get the grappling exchanges. That's when it makes it very exciting.
But you, Nisha, you've competed at the highest level. Do you listen to the referee if he tells you to engage, if he's telling you to go, or do you stick to your strategy and your game plan?
I definitely listen to the referee's warning. I heed them heavily because he's in charge of the bout. You know, he could definitely stop it at any time, or nice kick. You know, he can also take away points, and that can be a big change when the scorecard is tallied. Beautiful takedown by Chai. That was just a nice double leg flare. Ended up in side control here.
Yeah, you could see what Chai was trying to initiate there. He was looking for the hands combinations, and he was waiting for Tatsikin to come back at him, and
ooh,
that time he
went
right into it.
Look at this, Mitch. I think he might hop over to the other side here. If he can get across past that leg right at, he may get that head and arm choke. If he chooses to switch sides with his body there. See how he has that one arm up there? If he connects, all right, chooses to let go.
You can see Tatsikin just a little bit rough on the ground. Not quite as experienced when he has his back on the mat. We got about 30 seconds in this one, but he did a good job of getting back to full guard there as he's controlling, trying to control the posture as he's wrapping the Chai's head up to make sure he doesn't posture up and start dropping bombs.
Chai's doing a great job of keeping Tatsikin flat on the mat. It's something that you really don't want to be when you're in this kind of position. You want to get onto your side so you can become offensive.
Yeah, Chai's got a very heavy top game. He's very strong on top. Now he's just controlling in the top position, dropping a little bit of ground and pound. Good first round for Chai. Now, again, we do not score round by round, but if the match was stopped right here, how do you have this one going through now?
Oh, I definitely think Chai takes this one. Great grappling exchanges. You see here he did a great job scrambling. He's working his way back to the top, staying safe, not to get any submissions. And then he gets a beautiful takedown of his own here pretty soon. Oh, big overhand right by Tatsikin. That was probably the punch of the fight.
Yeah, that is definitely Tatsikin is having his, you know, opportunities in the striking exchanges, but when he gets
that
into that clinch.
A big takedown, though. Big double leg takedown. That was the statement of the round for me, I think, and really established the pace for the rest of the round. Getting on top and really establishing Chai's dominance throughout
Misha,
the round there.
Play coach right now. What do you got Chai doing? What do you think he should be doing in this second stanza?
I think, you know, he needs to fake some striking and look to get back on top. He's clearly dominant there. And Tatsikin is dangerous on the feet. You saw that big right hand that he landed. I would be telling my athlete to take this to the ground again.
Beautiful spinning back kick from Tatsikin that puts Chai on his backside. Nice little headlock takedown there to reverse the situation. He's much more effective when he gets on top.
Well, I think we can imagine what Tatsikin's coach has told him coming out in this round, is that you really got to get after it, and he is doing just that, spinning back kick to put him down, and really tenacious pace here in the second round.
He's got some serious strikes. When he throws and he does initiate first, he does very well. As we saw in the replay, he was able to land a big right hand, and now he's attacking the body with the spinning back kick.
Such good head movement too. He's really, Tatsikin's doing a great job of avoiding the damage of Chai. And Chai's throwing with power, but he's missing a lot.
Yeah, you wouldn't know it, but he actually started in his wrestling background. He went on to win several championships in freestyle wrestling, but Tatsikin's best weapon seems to be the striking department.
Yeah, great right hand so far. That's been the story of this bout, on the feet at least, really is that right hand of Tatsikin. There it is again. Excuse me, that one was Chai's returning. There we go. Now Chai's beginning to return.
Yeah, he wobbled Chai a little bit there, as you can see that right hand coming right over the top. And that's Chai's best weapon, as he throws that overhand right. Tatsikin was keeping his chin nice and tucked, but now it's starting to pop up in the air a bit. I think that's coming from excitement. But nice little exchanges there. That's dangerous when Chai gets in tight like that.
You know, I notice that Chai is still a little bit more plotty than Tatsikin. Tatsikin's light on the feet. That leads me to think he's not so much thinking about the wrestling where Chai is. He's plotty, and he's kind of still in the back of his mind thinking, after I hit him, I've got to find a way to get in.
But it's there. You can see how he closes distance. He throws that 1-2, and he's right there in position for a body lock takedown.
Yeah.
But he's not really choosing to go back to that. He did that successfully in the first round, but we're not seeing that here in the second. The right hand just landed again right there.
I think it might be coming. He's pushing forward. He's just waiting for the right opportunity for Tatsikin to commit.
Go fight!
Well, referee John Lai didn't believe the eye poke there and initiates the exchanges again.
It can be really difficult when you want to get someone to the ground and they're throwing with that kind of power, because you're so concerned about running into a punch. You make it so much more impactful if you miscalculate and you run straight into a punch. And I think that's what Chai is thinking about here, is he wants to get inside, he wants to get to the ground, but how? He's trying so hard to problem solve this right now. Tatsikin doing a great job of keeping him guessing with that movement and the aggression to start this round.
That right hand is a drip hammer. It's slicing right through the guard. You can see Tatsikin's got his hand nice and low, and that right hand is landed over and over again. He sets it up well with that hook.
Oh, and Tatsikin taking some damage, clearly wanting to enter and stop the onslaught from Chai.
Nice work.
That right hand was starting to land, and Tatsikin gets that body lock. Now he's got him pressed up against the corner. What can Chai do from here?
Well, I think Chai's actually in a better position here. See, now, yes, he's beginning to lock. Now he's got his hands locked. He very well, there we are with the takedown.
Beautiful outside trip to get Tatsikin back to the ground. And immediately he's flat on his back.
Watch back of the head.
He's inside, you know, last he's got warning. His opponent's inside control, so he needs to spin into his side.
Guys, no time.
He needs to turn onto that left shoulder and start working away. Look how much space is right there between their bodies. And he's just holding on, trying to keep that grip nice and tight.
Seems like Tatsikin is a little unsure of how to get up safely here without losing position, because each time he has, as you see here, it seems like Chai gets into a better position. And that can be so frustrating as the athlete who's trying to get up. And ooh, is he under the chin here?
Catch. No catch.
Good job from Chai to work back to the, he was trying to get the back, but he went after the choke and he didn't quite get it. Now these guys are starting to empty their tanks as we approach the third round, because there is a lot at stake for these guys, because they get that shot to punch their ticket to the big show as Chai's working from the back control position. You gotta see Tatsikin start to defend those hands.
Yeah, these exchanges are all happening so quick here. There's so much to break down. A beautiful knee. Wow.
Chai's just one step ahead in most of the grappling exchanges.
Awkward position right here. It's not. This is what I'm talking about, the box of chocolates. You really never know what you're gonna get, Mitch.
a pretty good second round. Again, Chai's coming out again in the second stanza. Misha, talk us through some of these highlights.
All right, here's the start of the round from Tasikin. Is a huge spinning back kick. Knocks Chai down to the ground, goes to follow up. And here are the right hands of Chai as he picked up some momentum through the latter half of the round.
Yeah, we got to see Tatsukin start that round so furiously, so aggressive. But then as the round starts to go on, you can see the experience coming from Chai. Chai was able to slow it down, get that body lock, and work to the ground. Looks like the doctors are checking out the mouth.
Yeah, it looked like they were checking out some of his teeth right there. So I think the stakes are really high in this round. It's probably, I know we don't score round by round, but it's a 50-50 fight right now.
You think so?
I think it is. Yeah. I think that it can be stolen here, I would say, by Tasikin. I would say Chai's a little bit ahead, but I think that Tasikin can steal it with that kind of momentum if he's able to keep that. But looks like we're having, what do you think's going on here, Mitch?
Looks like the doctor, Jimmy Wong, is taking a second look now at the possible mouth injury, I think, of Tatsukin. I think it happened from some of those huge overhand rights. If it is an injury to the mouth, but that hand, that right hand of Chai Xiangshang was touching up Tatsukin. I think that's what the just kind of this time.
It's a statement to the power, right? Okay.
It looks like he's good to go, and we will see a third round because this is a pretty good matchup. And like you said, it could be anybody's game if Tatsukin can put that pedal to the metal and start to pick the lead on Chai Xiangshang.
He starts out with what kind of pace in this round. That always says a lot. You know, who's got what left in the gas tank and in the heart going into the final round. I always say the first round is the athlete, usually the person who's more athletic can win that round, but the last round comes down to heart.
Oh, nice body kick landed by Chai Xiangshang. It sounded like we got the groin there, and I think that's what Chai Xiangshang was alluding to. But he's starting to go after the body right now with that left kick.
That looks like a weapon. Maybe his corner told him, hey, it's open, it's available. Let's try this technique. It's always so interesting to see how the athletes progress and how experienced they are in how they can adjust their game plans round by round like this. Powerful exchanges.
Oh, Tatsukin shooting in for the double leg takedown. Good defense there from Chai Xiangshang as he works his way again to the back.
Body lock, and he's so strong here. You have to know that Tatsukin is very frustrated. Now he sees he has Chai's hands locked around him. And he's probably going down here. Yep.
Now you can see that he's not even defending the hands, Misha. You know, you can see that he's choosing to slap the legs, go to the elbows, to the back of the head. I mean, you've competed, you've been in there, you know the wrestling better than anybody out there. What do you think, what is he doing wrong?
Well, he's not hand fighting. That's something that he needs to try to break the grip. That's the first thing. So, you know, he's just making a mistake here. He's gotten a bit away from his wrestling. And sometimes that happens as wrestlers transition to mixed martial arts. They get so excited by the something shiny aspect, you know, getting to be a striker and punch someone. And they forget sometimes the fundamentals.
You know, that's something shiny. You know what it's like to come off of a bunch of submissions, submitting people, beating people up round and round, but then you got your first head kick KO, and you got a little taste of what it's like to knock somebody out. So how does that change things for an athlete?
It definitely changes things. I mean, as you know, every bout changes something. Whether you win or you lose, it changes, you grow, you learn. And now we see here Chai getting this bout back to the ground where he's been so dominant.
Good explosion there from Tatsukin to work his way back up, and that seems to be his big thing.
Hands are locked. I bet he's going for a ride here. Now, if Chai can lift and kind of get those legs free, he's going to spin him right back down to the ground.
Nice little takedown there from Chai Xiangshang. He's really effective inside that body lock. Once the hands are locked, it's almost a no-brainer that Tatsukin's going for a ride.
Again, Tatsukin should be, you know, pushing the head down. Here we go. Now, this is more what we need to see, and not allowing those hands to get locked. Because, again, once they get locked, then it's time for a ride.
But he lands well. He's kind of like a cat, you know, as far as like his ability
to turn
his body. Yep. Make sure he ends up on his all fours and he's able to pop right back.
He's finding more success with that in this round. It just might be too little too late.
Stop.
Because he was cruising earlier. We saw that flying through the air a few times.
Referee Jonathan Lai has called a halt to the action because of the illegal elbows to the back of the head delivered by Tai Tzikian there to Chai Xiong Xiong. And I do believe it's going to be a... Depends on what the referee's going to call this one. I don't think it's an injury timeout. I think it's just going to go... doctor's going to check him out on the illegal strikes. Again, this is going to be a nice little breather for Tatsukin, who is getting outworked there, and a lot of that body lock controls.
Yeah. Anytime that the athletes can get a little bit of a breather like this, especially the one that's not injured, you know, it's it can sway things a little bit. So, yeah, clearly some strikes to the back of the head. You know, we were concerned here with athlete safety, so that's why this rule is in place. You know, you're not supposed to attack behind, you know, behind the clearly the back of the head or the spine. And you get hit in the back of the head, the damage just kind of compiles more, and it's a sensitive area because that's all the nerve endings of where the spine is. So you really can do, you know, damage beyond, I think, just what we're looking for here in a martial arts bout. So we don't want the athletes to sustain serious injury if at all possible, so we always make that an off-limits area.
Now, an athlete is allowed up to 5 minutes for recovery, and since we are past the halfway point of this particular three-round match, if the match was stopped or he was unable to continue, the match would go to the scorecards, but you can see he's trying to land to the ear there, but then the last elbow was clearly, you have to make contact to the ear if you're gonna strike the side of the head, and you could see clearly that that last strike was located right behind the ear.
And I don't think that Tasikin meant to do that, you know. I think when you're in the bout like that, I think it was so close. I really believe he was aiming to be in the right position, but it's difficult sometimes. So as I'm watching the replay, the first two were in the right position, and then there was just a small movement, and the last one ended. See, those were both legal, and that last one just came at the wrong angle. It does happen, unfortunately.
But you can see,
Chai kind of turned his head.
Turned his head ever so slightly right as he was initiating that throw. So it is an injury timeout. They are allowed the duration of one round for recovery, and if they don't, if they are unable to continue, we will go to the judges' scorecards because we are past the halfway point. And in such a closely contested match, how do you see it going so far?
I think if the bout were to be concluded at this point, I would definitely say that the red corner, Chai, has won this bout with his wrestling and dominance on the ground. He also came in the latter half of the first and second round with some great overhand rights that actually had Tatsukin wanting to shoot himself, but really didn't find much success in his wrestling in this match. So,
yeah, he was punched in the face and he changed his mind real fast about striking to going for the double leg takedown.
Yeah.
And Chai Xiong Chong was able to stop that, you know, and looked pretty good, you know, overall. He just needs to polish a few things up. I think both these guys are. I don't know if he is going to be able to continue. We might have to go to a technical decision and hand this one off to the judges.
I guess we'll have to see what happens here. But, you know, Tatsukin, he's got it in his mind right now that he has some time. I think he's hoping that this will continue because...
Now, the athlete is allowed up to 5 minutes for medical examination and recovery. If an athlete is unable to resume in the allotted time, an official decision will be given. And because we are past the halfway point, we will go to the judges' scorecards at this particular time. Let's take a look at it again, Misha.
All right, this replay again. First elbow, second elbow is legal. And then you see Chai kind of turn his head away. So really not the fault of Tatsukin whatsoever. Actually, that was really more dictated by Chai, so I'm glad that they're not taking this away from Tatsukin. I don't think it was intentional on his part at all.
Okay, it looks like we are headed to the judges' scorecards, and I think Chai was wearing to go. He was trying to get ready, but the doctors didn't quite give him the okay. Athlete safety is our number one priority here in ONE Championship, and we want to make sure that he continues to compete another day. But according to Misha Tate, she sees it the way of...
I see it the way as Chai. I think that he did enough in this bout. I think overall his riding time, every wrestling exchange really came out to his dominance, and the position on the ground was primarily controlled by him the entire bout. And I think it was competitive. Competitive on the feet. I might give Tatsukin the edge. The aggression, that big spinning back kick to lead off the second round was quite impressive, and he had some great jabs and right hands, but I don't think it was enough for him to get this decision. So I guess we'll see what the judges have to say. You never really know.
See referee John Lai trying to get the athlete back to the center of the ring to announce the winner here. Chai definitely seems really concerned, really upset about not being able to continue, but it looks like we will have a possible unanimous decision victory out of the red corner for Chai Xiong Xiong to improve his record and look to compete another day. But ladies and gentlemen, we are just getting started here from Shanghai, China. Mitch Chilson alongside the champion, the one and only, the cupcake, Misha Tate. We will see.
Here we go! Step Vertex!
Step Vertex versus Alma Junaku for the Animate Muay Thai world title.
Coming up next in the strawweight division is a mixed martial arts contest between Wang Mao Lun and Li Jie. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the global rule set. We're gonna go 3 5-minute rounds, bout judged in its entirety, not round by round. No kicks to the head of a ground opponent, no spiking or suplexing on the head, neck, or spine. In the blue corner is Li Jie. He is a Brazilian jiu-jitsu artist with a strong background in wrestling. He is in the red and black shorts. And in the red corner is Li Hao Jie, who is a Sanda practitioner. This again, we have seen Li Jie before in ONE Championship. Actually, no, we have seen Li Hao Jie before in ONE Championship. He has 2 wins and 1 loss. A very experienced mixed martial artist here in ONE Hero Series. This should be a good matchup between a Brazilian jiu-jitsu artist and a Sanda practitioner. 2 highly experienced strawweights.
Right, judge. Judge. Judge time.
Again, they have the opportunity to rocket themselves to superstardom. And Wang Mao Lun immediately comes out with 2 beautiful left hands to touch up the face of Li Jie. Wang Mao Lun looks for that.
Watch back
at getting taken down as Li Jie works his way into side control, but a good job of retaining guard for Wang Mao Lun.
Wow, this is a good scramble here. There's definitely good pace. I know we have mounted by Li. So he's definitely utilizing that wrestling that you were talking about, that jiu-jitsu. Ooh, and he may be transitioning to an armbar here, but decides to settle instead. You know, that's a smart decision sometimes early in a round to just kind of allow the energy, so to speak, of the person below you to just kind of wear out a little before you decide to go for a submission.
He just trying to keep this position. He's doing a good job of maintaining mount. Wang's trying to push away. He's trying to create space, but Li just got a very heavy top game and controlling the mount very well. You can see Wang trying to control the head to avoid that possible ground and pound, but he needs to push away on the hips to create space. Now he does a good job of hip escaping out.
But Lee's really relentless here. Oh, and he's got a head and arm choke here. Settling in nicely. This is tight. This is tight. This may be over right here. Really, Wang needs to bridge and try to roll through that if at all possible. Bridge or get his arm through. Another technique is to answer the phone. You put that left arm out and the tap. That was a quick one, Mitch.
Wow. What a
dominant performance by Lee.
Lee Juk came out like a house on fire and really took it to Wang Mao Lun. Got on top control, looked beautiful once he got on top, and then just you could see him setting up that head and arm choke beautifully. Talk us through this, Misha.
That feels so good when you could come out and just implement a perfect game plan. Here you see he transitions to the mount. He's able to catch that arm by the head, goes ear to ear right here, gets that pressure with his arm on the one side and his opponent's arm on the other, cutting off those carotid arteries. And it looks like Wang had no choice but to tap.
Again, Li Zhe announces his arrival to One Hero Series with a first round submission victory. I think that was under 2 minutes, maybe, it looked like, from Li Zhe as Jonathan Lai announces the blue corner as the victor here in Shanghai, China.
Winner!
Beautiful, Li Zhe.
Barely broke a sweat.
Barely, not even shiny, not even sweating. Beautiful job, Li Zhe. Don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. We've got an awesome night set up for you here in Shanghai, China.
This is our journey. This is our mission. All of the places. All of the people. All of the smiles. The prayers. The late nights. The preparation. All of the sweat and tears. It's the match of our lives. It's our dedication to greatness. This is our world. This is our stage.
And there it is! Olympic! Come on! Good night! I bring how about this? Enzo Gracie back!
Touch out! She's done it! Angela Lee!
This crowd's going bananas! Ah!
I did it! All over!
Is this the time? Is this the moment?
The roar around me is
One.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. One Hero Series here from Shanghai, China. Up next in the flyweight division is Li Hao Jie taking on Huang Yan Chuan. Global rules set on this one. We're going to go 3 5-minute rounds, bout judged its entirety, not round by round. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent. No spiking or suplexing on the head, neck, or spine. In the red corner, we have Li Hao Jie in the black and white shorts. And then in the blue corner, we have Huang Yan Chuan in the gray shorts.
Ready, go!
And it is time.
These strawweights come out so fast and furious as we see Huang pushing forward, throwing big hands. You can see him trying to control the center of the ring there as he's moving back and forth. Nice overhand right.
Loses his balance there.
You know he was putting everything into that punch. See him trying to corner Lee, backing him up into the corner. We have seen Li Haojie three times before in one championship, so he is a veteran, and he looks to put on a show here in Shanghai, China.
You know, not really much of a feeling out process here. They're both swinging to land damage. They're, that was a clear groin shot, accidental, but sounded painful. I don't know, Mitch. I've never been there.
Let's take a look at it.
Yeah, that
we had to see that again.
That looked painful.
We've got an injury time. An athlete is allowed up to 5 minutes for medical examination and recovery. An athlete is unable to resume in the allotted time. An official decision will be given. Now let's take a look at this. You can see him trying to go for that inside leg kick, but then bingo, right on the money.
Just a couple inches too high there. It's an easy miscalculation when you are in the heat of the moment.
Yeah, you know, you're just going for that inside leg kick, and especially when there's a height differential like we have here, you know, it depends on, you know, who your sparring partners are and how used you are to throwing that inside leg kick, but it's nothing malicious on his behalf. He's just trying to score.
So Mitch, do you think that affects the ability to focus?
It does. You know, it definitely puts a halt. Your entire nervous system just sort of shuts down, and it's really distracting, but it can also stop the flow of everything as well. But these guys are pros, and they're getting right back into the exchanges. They definitely sense what's at stake for them here at this with this opportunity, and they're trying to go all out.
I'm really impressed with the accuracy of Lee. You see here those leg kicks, the body kicks, they're all landing with precision and with power.
Man, I don't know if the microphone is extremely close to these guys, but they are throwing some serious heat at one another. They are cracking.
And you hear those kinds of shots landing, and you're just glad you're not the one on the receiving end, right?
Man, like, you can hear the thud of these small gloves. And just the power that these little guys are throwing with. They're straw weights. These are the lighter weights, and they're throwing some serious heat.
Definitely developing power. Yeah, you know, as they're excited, and as mentioned, there's not much of a feeling out process here. We'll see how that translates as this goes on. You know, it's not even halfway through the first round.
Beautiful elbow there as he came over the top from Li Haojie. He is extremely accurate with his shots. I like when he starts putting combinations together, when he starts throwing the hands and then ends on the kick. Li Haojie's got good combinations, but then he also got those little subtle head shifts. When he throws the kicks, he's not in the center line, which enables Huang to counter.
Yeah, Huang is swinging a lot, but he's been missing a little bit, so that takes a lot of energy.
Oh.
Ouch, that's another unintentional groin shot here on the exchange, on the other receiving end this time.
See that? He jumped into that one. He was trying to land that push kick again. You can see he's been setting up that push kick ever so often, and then it was just a mistimed sort of shot right there. You can see he jumped into that one. In injury time, an athlete is allowed up to 5 minutes for medical examination and recovery. And since we haven't reached the halfway point of this particular match, it will be ruled a no contest. But once we hit the halfway point, then it goes to the judges' scorecard.
If they're not able to continue, but both these guys are very tough, and it looks like they will be able to continue. A little warning for the referee to keep it clean, keep it safe.
It looks like they're even now in the
great
shot category, so we'll call it 1-1 there. So the slate's wiped clean, and just as I say that.
Did you jinx it, Mitch?
And then Huang Yan Chuan scores another one with the groin shot. And we have had more injury time than we've had action in this one, unfortunately. But these are just minor little, you can see him going, he tried to went across the other side there, you know, a la Rob Kaman as he tried to step across to the other side with the leg kick, but he just touched him again. It looks like they're ready to get back into the action again. See, I like the combinations that he's throwing. He doubles them up, and he doesn't just end with one or two shots. He always kind of ends with a kick right there.
Agreed. And good movement by Lee to get out of the way of damage. You see, he doesn't just back up either. He's actually got great lateral movement. So he moves to the side to side well. His entrances are good. See that? He's able to actually get out of the way of the damage and circle out. I think that's what's winning him this bout so far. Actually, it's not necessarily the offense, but it's his ability to escape the defense. He gets in, he lands what he needs to, and then he gets out of range.
You know, do you think there's going to be, is somebody going to, I mean, you can see
here
just
we
as
are.
He went
I
in there.
Knew what you were going to ask. I think you have some kind of jinxing ability in this, Mitch.
Nice little double leg takedown there from Huang as he ends up in a guillotine. Now, the guillotine doesn't quite look like it's more of a stalling technique rather than a choke.
Yeah, that's because we see here that Huang is driving in, driving forward. He's defending that guillotine well. Obviously has practiced this defense before. So now we'll see what he can do from the top position here.
You can see Li Hao Jie started to swivel the hips. He was trying to possibly attack an arm bar. Looks like he's going for a triangle. Good job, but go after the triangle. Missed the triangle and then throw an up kick to the face there.
Yeah, he was able to create just enough space to slip back up to his feet.
He's crafty. Very interesting subtleties from Li Hao Jie. And they're very little intricate little moves like the head movement, getting off the center line. He's a very skilled martial artist. He did win an eight-man tournament called Heroic Legend back there in China.
He's got to be so... he keeps... That's about the third time now. And it, just before that, I saw him kind of nick that groin area. He just is throwing those a little too high. Here's the replay again. You see those are really aiming for the midsection. He's got to make an adjustment or... At the very least, points are going to be taken. At the very worst, this may be the end because that was a pretty gnarly sounding groin shot there.
Yeah, that one, that wasn't even just the foot. Like, that was almost shin to cup because he tried to come across it again. He's just coming a little bit too low. He doesn't quite have the accuracy of Li Hao Jie.
So, Mitch, has this ever happened to you?
Unfortunately, in my fourth kickboxing match, I got kicked in the groin and the cup actually split.
No.
It split and opened up and then it came back out taking, not a nice memory for myself. Thanks for bringing that up there,
Misha. Yeah, I see you're kind of cringing in your chair a little bit over here.
it was a horrific experience. And this is like
Was that bout ending?
That was actually not bout ending. I took 4 minutes, but they actually let me continue. And
with
a
broken cup.
I went on to win. They gave me a new cup.
All right,
well,
back
to combinations. He's got good combinations, and he moves around really well. I do believe that referee Kemp Chang issued a yellow card to Huang Yan Chuan. And in this case, that will be a 10% purse deduction from Huang. As he landed, I mean, that has to be a beautiful overhand elbow there landed by Li Hao Jie.
And another overhand right, just barely missing. And the takedown here, the only one of this bout so far. You know what I think I'm really surprised with is how well Li has been able to, Huang has been able to recover from those groin shots. Really, every time he comes out and there's no... hesitation on his part.
Then it's also hard because you've been fouled repeatedly. That's got to take kind of like a little bit
you
of...
You would think.
Like you start to get a little bit angry. You start to get a little bit, you start to lose that composure. You don't have, it takes you away from your game plan.
So Mitch, what happens if there's another foul this round?
I do believe the referee could take a point. You know, if he sees it happen repeatedly. Now, I don't think he's trying to attack the groin. I don't think that's what he's going after. But it's happened a little too often, I think. And it's also starting to affect Li Hao Jie's performance as well. You might want to start going for that outside leg kick instead of just keep going throwing that inside leg kick.
See the adjustments. I always love seeing the second round because I'm always curious how the athletes will adjust.
Well, you can see Huang was originally in the southpaw stance, and he's actually switched now to orthodox because of that particular reason. I think it leads to a double leg a little bit easier. But Li Hao Jie pops right back up.
And I'm sure that was probably some advice coming from Li's corner. you know, to expect that and look for the counter here. Now he ends up on top, actually. Not the one initiating the shot, but finds his way to the ground anyways. And back to the feet.
Huh, Li Haojie actually let him up there. Just chooses to keep it back up on his feet. I like how he sets everything up with the jab. The jab looks real sharp coming out of Li Haojie.
Huang has a more chaotic style, and he's definitely swinging. I call it swinging for the fences. He's got this overhand right, overhand left style. That lends itself a lot of times to that type of back heel trip, connecting kind of style when you want to get about to the ground. But when it stays on the feet, as you notice, I think that Li is getting the cleaner of the exchanges.
Yeah, Huang has a very linear path. He's either going forward or he's coming back, and we get to see Li Haojie kind of move left and right, a little bit better in the footwork area, and he's able to avoid a lot of these shots, especially when Huang starts to rush forward, which kind of is that jumping sort of pattern that he's got. Nice little body shot landed by Li Haojie. He goes after
and
again.
And another one. And the back heel chip, but Huang doing a great job. Every time you think that he's down, it's like he has a spring on his butt and he just flips the position.
Is it because of the takedown of Huang? Is he not fully?
You know what I think that it is that Huang's coming in with this very diving-like takedown, so he has a lot of momentum going forward, and Li is essentially just able to redirect that motion. Oh, and an armbar scramble attempt here. That was close.
You can see Huang, he's very, very tricky off his back. He's constantly throwing up his hips, but now he's got to turn around. You don't want to give your back to your opponent like that. He's got to stay. You can see he's trying to turn, but Li Haojie is very heavy now on the side control.
Drops a quick elbow on the way there. And we'll see. There's a potential for an armbar there. He has that arm isolated. Not sure if he's thinking about that or if he'd rather just deliver some ground and pound here.
He could slide over with a knee on belly there. He's got that arm in a very precarious position, but I don't think he's choosing to go for a submission. I think he just wants to beat up Huang.
Yeah, well, ground and pound is a submission in its own right, so it may be how he's choosing to end this bout. If that.
Man, those sounds.
And you can hear how hard these athletes are breathing. And they're really putting everything into this.
Man, kudos to the sound guy, because we are definitely right in the action as he tries to crucifix the right here arm here of Huang. As we're in north and south position, one person's kind of the opposite of the other one. Li Haojie chooses to let him up, throws a nice little kick on the exit there.
That's an interesting decision, in my opinion, from Li, because he was so dominant in that position, and I don't think it was too far off from being stopped, because Huang was covering instead of wanting to get. Huang may be out of this bout right now. It seems like mentally maybe something has shifted, and he's just not quite in it like he was the first round.
I think this is what Li Haojie wanted. He's got him up into the corner, and he's starting to let it go. You can slowly start to see Huang Yan Chuan's energy start to fade, but Li Haojie might be a little bit tired from beating up Huang at this point.
Yeah, but you know, he's an experienced guy. He's got a lot more experience, and you can see that as this is shifting. He knows it. He's been here before. He's been through the trouble. He's been through the adversity, and he doesn't mind swimming in deep waters.
Beautiful knee, the clinch there. I like how he's attacking the body, too. Beautiful kicks to the body are just slowly sucking the energy out of Huang.
Remember, Mitch, at the beginning of this, I said, let's see how this energy pace translates later on. These guys were so excited, and there wasn't much of a feeling out process. Now we see Huang just trying to survive to the next round. It looks like he will probably make it to the third round. Let's see maybe if his coaches can say something to him that could inspire him to come out with a better attitude in the third round.
Man, Li was lighting him up in that corner there, Misha.
That's absolutely right. And there was a beautiful body kick there, which actually kind of was caught and led to an attempted takedown by Huang, but immediately reversed by Li to establish some great ground and pound position and an armbar attempt. This was close. I really thought this was going to be a done deal, to be honest. I thought he was going to roll under, but great job blocking that leg from coming through. That would have been the finishing move. Really interesting scramble. Very intense. That one had me on the edge of my seat.
Misha, play coach to these guys. What do you have for Huang? We think he's behind right now. What advice would you give to Huang?
I would just say you have to dig deep. You know, five more minutes, that's always something that I appreciated hearing in my corner, was 5 minutes. I would always think I could do anything for 5 minutes. You know what I mean? Like, five more minutes, that's all I have. Okay, you know, I could do anything for 5 minutes. So I think your reminder that what's on the line here, and then it's only five more minutes, let's just give it everything you have. And being willing to lose in 5 minutes, but, you know, give it everything you have. Just risk it all. I remember thinking that in the fifth round with Holly Holm when I went out, that I had to just, like, leave it all on the line. That's the position, really, that Huang is in right now. It's 5 minutes to nothing, you know, so go for broke.
A movie should be made out of the fifth round of your Holly Holm fight. But here we go, back into the action, as Huang is trying to dig deep. Now, in the corner, do you think they tried to pump him up, or did they give him actually advice he could use in this round?
Personally, if I was in the corner, I'd be trying to get the mentality back, because I think that he has a way to win this, but he's got to believe in himself, right? He had some great takedowns and success. He just needed to stick the landing a little better. So we'll see how bad he wants this. I think that Lee is off to a good start here, though.
You can see Huang still going back to those leg kicks, but he has reversed his stance, so he's not in southpaw where he was throwing that inside leg kick to the groin of Lee, and now he's switched to orthodox, and now he's starting to still touch up that leg.
And he's in the corner again, though. This is one place where I would have been advising, do not sit in the corner. Don't get cornered by Lee, because it just allows for that onslaught.
But that's what we've seen. We've seen in the first couple rounds, Huang only has a linear path. He only has linear footwork. He just kind of follows around Lee. As Lee changes angles, that's when you see Huang. But a beautiful double leg takedown again from him.
Those are scoring heavily. And he stuck the landing. That's what he needed. He didn't dive in for that takedown. He picked him up and he planted him and they stuck. Now, this will be really one of the first times that we get to see our scramble tip. We're back to the feet. I thought we were going to get to see some ground action there, but these guys have other plans in mind.
But Li Haojie kind of uses the submission as a way to create a little bit of space to threaten his opponent, and then he just bounces right back up off of the submission attempt.
Yeah, it is a good transition, and it works really well for him.
Because you can almost see that the opponent pulls away and it gives him that space so he's able to roll out the back and get back up. Nice body kick landed by Li Haojie.
Good combination. He's looking for a knee or a kick there. Just barely missing. I think that Lee is starting to look for a finishing move here. I think he's setting up those leg kicks, setting up the body kicks, but I wouldn't be surprised now if we start to see him go a little bit high. Now that Huang is tired, his hands are dropping. Yes, you see Lee is getting him to think about the low kicks as an experienced martial artist. There we go. There's that high kick. That's what I would be expecting from someone with quite a bit of martial arts experience.
Man, but Huang's tough. You know, he's eating a lot of these shots. He's basically playing the role of a punching bag at this point because he is eating a lot of body shots, and they're not just going at one spot, like you said. Beautiful body kick right there.
Back to his feet, though. What heart. You know, Huang is definitely durable, and he's definitely tough. But at this point, I think we're starting to see that he's outmatched.
He's definitely got the toughness factor nailed.
Yeah, and perhaps just expended a little bit too much energy. It's hard to tell in that first round, because as you become a veteran, you can go at that pace, but the excitement level that you have, you're able to control it better. And we see Lee going for takedown, but getting stuffed.
Beautiful takedown defense there from Lee Yan Chuan as he's in side control. I think he's got about 75 seconds here to finish it. If he can pour it on, this could be his best shot at capturing the W.
Huang on top here.
Ah, very tricky escape there from Li Haojie. Did the right thing, turned into the body, created the scramble, slipped out the backside.
He's really good at that, Lee. He's managed to create that space a few times and get back to the feet. A couple deep breaths, but for both athletes, as this this bout is waning the last minute here.
Oh, beautiful! Spinning.
Did I not call that, Mitch? I said the head kick is coming. That was a great finish. Wow.
Wow, Hao Jie throws the spinning back fist to high roundhouse to finish Huang Yan Chuan with a beautiful head kick. Misha Tate going Nostradamus, calling the shot, gets the head kick knockout. We got to see a replay of that because that was beautiful, Misha.
That was good here. So we're gonna take a couple looks at this. The spinning back fist was really a distraction. And it distract it did, as we see, it skims off the head. And Huang thought he had defended it, and then the head kick was there to follow. That was a beautiful shot. Devastating. Well timed, well played, and trickery. You know, that's a veteran move right there.
Winner!
Li Huang Jie gets a huge knockout victory at One Hero Series. Don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. We are just getting started here in Shanghai, China.
Fairtex versus Alma Juniku for the Anamite Muay Thai world title.
ที่สองมันเป็นมวยไทยมันก็ต้องอยู่กับคนไทยเราก็ต้องพยายามรักษาป้องกันแชมป์ไว้ให้ได้ตลอดพอเป็นแชมป์เปี้ยน2เส้นทั้งมวยไทยคิกบ็อกซิ่งคือมันเหมือนยกระดับตัวเองแล้วก็ยกระดับ
She's already won kickboxing and Muay Thai and going for another belt is going to put even more training toughness for her. Right now, she's training for Muay Thai to defend her belt, but we still require her to train mixed martial art at least twice a week, you know, and BJJ at least 3 times a week, so she won't forget her move. If you want to be the best, if you want to have 3 belts, that's what you have to do.
อย่างเช่นแองเจล่าลีอย่างเช่นเมยักกุชิก็คือหนูเข้าไปดูว่าเขาต่อยยังไงคือเขาเป็นคนที่แบบทักษะเขาเยอะแล้วเขาเป็นคนแบบแข็งแรงอันนี้ยากสำหรับหนูก็คือเราต้องหมั่นซ้อมหมั่นฝึกหมั่นทุกอย่างที่เราไม่เป็นต้องเป็นให้หมดก็คือโอกาสคนเรามันจะไม่เท่ากันค่ะโอกาสบางคนมันมาแล้วไม่รีบคว้ามันก็น่าเสียดาย
Event tomorrow night in Shanghai, but up next in One Hero Series is a flyweight tilt as we go mixed martial arts as Yang Fu Chong takes on Yan Shi Huan. Global rules sit on this one, ladies and gentlemen. We're gonna go 3 5-minute rounds, bout judged its entirety, not round by round. No spiking or suplexing on the head, neck, or spine. In the red corner is Yang Fu Chong, a Sanda practitioner. And then in the blue corner is Yen Ji Yuan, a wrestler.
Judge.
So we have seen these two in won championship before, and we've got the classic striker versus grappler battle. Misha Tate, what do you think of this one?
I always love a good classic matchup, right? But, you know, I know it sounds cliche, I've said it earlier, but you just never know what you're going to get, honestly. And that's truly the thrilling and fascinating part of martial arts.
Yan in the blue corner, a little bit of height disadvantage from Yan. He's trying to get nice and tight, utilize those hands. And Yang trying to close that distance, get in tight. He does come from a Sanda background, so he does have a lot of throws in his arsenal as well, but a beautiful double leg attempt there from Yan, but stuffed by Yang.
Yang looking to establish a jab, so he's got a good stiff punch behind that, and he doesn't want to close too much distance here. You can see that as he moves out quickly. He wants to establish range, and the jab is really key to that. So we see Yang utilizing that tool and that weapon. And I think if he's able to land that with some success, we will see more combinations to follow.
Now, both these gentlemen have competed in One Hero Series before on two occasions, and they are looking for their first win. Now, Misha, what does a win here at One Hero Series do for an athlete?
Well, I mean, it's one step closer to getting that slot on the One Championship roster, which is where everybody here in Asia and even globally, many people want to be. So the opportunity is big, the pressure is on, and both these athletes know that a win here tonight does big things for their future and their careers.
Beautiful distance closing by Yang. He's trying to get it nice and tight. He has a beautiful jab in that straight right hand. Excellent straight punches coming from Yang.
Yang keeping it simple at first, but as I had explained, if that jab continues to find a home, we will see more punches coming off of that. You see that bit of a circular motion there with the right hand. He's playing with the eye line and the eyesight, kind of trying to distract and hide any motion from those fists flying towards the face of Yan. You know, we notice here there's quite a bit of a height difference, if you look. That can definitely play a factor in the range control. As Yan wants to get inside, he's got a lot more real estate that he has to cover in order to get inside on the long, rangy, lanky athlete in Yan. But here he finds some success.
Yan
does do so.
Yan was tenacious with that takedown. He eventually got it. We saw some good defense from Yang, but eventually Yan was able to work his way in to secure that takedown. Now he's doing a little bit of top control, trying to get past the guard of
those
Yang.
Long legs.
But we saw it with Yang on the feet. He looked real sharp, utilizing that reach advantage beautifully with that jab. But Yang on the ground, you can just see where he comes from that wrestling background, and he's extremely tough on top.
It's definitely, he's looking to drop some knees right here, drop some damage. And we'll see, we're seeing here now, we see Yang kind of just trying to hang on here until the right opportunity presents itself to escape without taking damage, because Yan is very aggressive right here, and he has the ability to do a lot of damage, not just to the head, but as you see, he's working the body here, keeping Yang guessing where these strikes are coming from.
And you can just kind of see the inexperience of Yang a little bit, just trying to hold on in that bottom position, trying to bridge out, not really creating a lot of the space that he should. You know, he's trying to turn away from Yan, which puts him in a bad spot.
So Yan is doing an excellent job at keeping Yang guessing. Where am I going with this? What strikes am I landing? And really beautifully executing that here on the ground.
He's got a very smothering, punishing style. He's constantly doing damage. He's always trying to hit him with little shots, shoving his hand in his face, covering up his mouth.
Inside.
Did you like that technique? Did you like to cover up people's mouths?
I still do. Did I? Do I ever? I just did it the other day, and somebody looked at me and said, is that legal?
Weren't you out there in Japan the other day rolling with Imanari and those
things?
No,
that was great. I didn't get a chance to cover Imanari's mouth. He was too busy twisting my legs in all different directions.
Ready? Go!
Recentered here.
You can see Yang, he's just holding on. He's got to create that space. Just good job to create a little bit of a scramble. But again, we're seeing that wrestling background. Just one step ahead of the exchange is Yang.
Stop.
Interesting first round. Interesting first round. The first half looked like it was Yang. The second half looked like it was Yan.
That's a big overhand right there. And another straight right return there by Yang. And this was a big knee to the head right here. We'll get to see this one. Ooh, that was powerful. You might remember because there's no padding on the knees, so those, when they land, they definitely chip away at the armor, chink away a little bit more than just a punch would do, typically.
You definitely see in the first half of that round, it was all Yang. Beautiful striking, nice hand work, good. But then once Yan was able to get that takedown, get on top, he did a lot of good time, a lot of good work when he was in the top position.
So here goes second round. We're going to see if these athletes are able to implement any changes, because I think both had some success in different areas. So we'll see what the adjustment has been made in that near 60 seconds. Such a short time to have a break, but really so much can change when you have that 60 seconds to talk to your coaches and kind of gather your wits about you. Again, we see Yang coming out with that jab. Oh, the straight right. Oh, one over another. Onslaught pouring on the pressure here. Yang.
That right hand is something special. It comes through. It just keeps coming. He throws that right hand out there, and he can just find that accuracy and that perfect pinpoint precision that he's got. He keeps looking for it, but he can't get too overzealous. He's got to remember to stop that takedown. He is a bit of a veteran. He's 10-6. On his professional record, while Yang is, I think he is 2-3.
So look at the damage here on Yan. You see his nose, and you talk about, you see that he was getting that ice on his face between rounds. So it's definitely something that he's noticed. And when you start to wear that damage, when the nose gets broken, a lot of times that changes the ability to effectively enter. It's clear that Yan wants to get this to the ground, right? But you see, he's also nervous about getting in that range. So this becomes more difficult, right, Mitch?
He's got to try to get past those hands of Yang, that beautiful jab and that straight right hand. And you can start to see him get a little bit hesitant with it. He's a little bit gun shy shooting in like that. Good sprawl from Yang, but now he worked his way back up to the upper body clinch.
Yeah, that double leg was pretty easily defended, but you look at him, relentless here is Yan. He wants to get this down. He does not want to be on the receiving ends of those strikes any longer, but he may not have a choice. Yang doing a great job of pummeling those underhooks. But he needs to be a little patient here. He needs to create a little more space before he dives back in.
You might want to try to, you can see Yang, he did a beautiful job of getting those underhooks, prying Yang up.
Look, Rang's trying to get to his back here. If he can turn that corner or just settle for a guard position,
But Yan is relentless in those takedowns. He's like a dog with a bone. Once he gets a hold of that body lock or one of those legs, he does not want any part of the hands of Yang. He definitely senses the urgency in this opportunity.
He's already wearing the damage, you know. He knows that that's not where he wants to be in this bout. So getting it back to the ground was a smart game plan by Yan in his corner. Those are hard body shots as well. That disrupts the breathing. You know, people think, what's that really doing? You know, but it affects the way you're able to breathe because you kind of have to keep your body tense. It's really exhausting to have somebody just wailing away at the ribs and the stomach like that.
You can see him going body, body, head, big body shots, landing a beautiful little close range hook to the left side of the body, and he's just starting to do damage. He's just starting to wear him out. And these shots, they're scoring, and it's also preventing a stand up.
And you see Yang trying to wrap him up, to tie those arms up, but Yan doing a great job. See, pushing his face down every time and not allowing for any type of stalling or real defense to come from Yan. Just landing that grounded pound. Short elbows there to the face. So busy on the ground as Yan. And desperately not wanting this bout to get back to its feet. Yan is chasing that takedown. And that's so frustrating, Mitch, isn't it, when you want a bout to go to the ground and you get it there and then somebody gets back up?
But he was able to have a little bit of success. If he was able to pop right back up, that would be demoralizing. You worked so hard for the takedown, and you finally get it, and then he just bounced right back up.
Oh, that was a big knee. That definitely hurt Yan. Let's see if he's able to recover from that. That one stung.
Yang is a very smooth striker on the feet. You can see his sprawl and brawl sort of mentality. He likes, got to defend that takedown, and you can start to see Yan starting to slow down a little bit.
And not to mention, as they get sweaty, it's a little bit more difficult as well.
Yan's got a little awkward sort of movement as he sort of bobs and weaves in there.
He's trying so hard to get past that range and that long, accurate reach of Yang. So he's trying anything to get outside the movement to really find his way inside to the clinch.
Yang does have a 15 centimeter height advantage that he has utilized very well. But once you get on the ground, a lot of that reach advantage gets nullified.
Swinging for the fences. Just Yan just trying to close distance with those punches more than anything. Oh, and another big knee. Those have got to hurt.
And that ends the second round. Interesting tale of two matches we're seeing right here. We're seeing the effective ground control of Yang versus the hands of Yang.
All right, so we see right hand, followed by another right hand, followed by another right hand here. Yang doing a great job shutting down the wrestling pressure from Yan and just pouring on those right hands. I think those are what did most of the damage to the face of Yan.
Interesting second round. How do you have it so far? Where do you see, is it the ground control of Yang or is it the hands of Yang?
It's really hard to say at this point. I'm not sure what would be weighing heavier on the judge's mind, but I will say going into this round, I think that Yang is picking up the momentum. I think he's getting a little bit better, a little bit more comfortable with that defense, and he's starting to find that timing, and Yan is becoming a little more hesitant to enter because
ready,
of that.
Ready, go!
Third round underway. Mitch Chilson alongside the world champion, Misha Cupcake Tate, and we are coming to you live from Shanghai, China. Big miss of an overhand right there thrown by Yang in the blue corner, Yang in the red.
Yang has to be careful here, though, not to get overzealous, because there's still some heat on those punches that Yan is throwing. None of them can be underestimated at this point.
Yan is just relentless in that takedown, but he chains the takedowns really well together. He's going from one to the other. It's not like he's shooting in for a takedown, failing and getting stopped, but he's consistently progressively moving from takedown to takedown.
You know, he used that 60 seconds to recover well, and now he's got a burst of energy, and he's trying to make the most of it. You know, Yan knew he needed to get this to the ground. That's where he's had a distinct advantage. So he does so early in this round. He's got nearly 4 minutes to work here. That's a long time. That's very early in the round for Yang to be put onto his back.
This is his opportunity to really start to put pressure. He's not even trying to, you know, advance his position. He's okay to just sit in the guard of Yang because he isn't feeling any submission threat.
He's doing damage here, Mitch. These are not soft punches. I mean, listen to that. You hear that landing? And those short elbows, I mean, those can do some real damage. They don't have to have much distance, you know? Just a little tiny bit of space for those short elbows is all it really takes to, you know, to cut someone open. You don't have to have a lot of real estate. So he's okay staying in this close quarters. Because he is hurting Yang here. Look at Yang, the way that he kind of peels himself off the mat. I mean, if that's not a display of the pressure that Yen is putting on here, I don't know what is.
Ready? Go!
Referee just moved him out of position because they were a little too close to the ropes and wanted to restart him in the center of the ring.
So, you know, look, Yang is pulling on the head here, but he's not using any counter motion. You're just hanging on the head here isn't going to stop the onslaught of Yang. If anything, he's just kind of holding himself in position here. So if I was in the corner of Yang, I would be yelling to push his face away, create some space, and try to get back to the feet here.
You can see he's not very comfortable. He might be a little bit tired because the feet aren't even going to the hips. He's not trying to create any space at all. And just Yen is just relentless, constantly doing work, putting in damage.
See, here we are. He's roping over the head here. He's tying up over the head, but that really just pulls Yen down into the position that he's already willing to be and willing to let. Look at the redness of the ribcage right there. You see those strikes, they're adding up. And they're definitely going to weigh heavy on the judges' scorecard should this go the minute 40 we have left.
That reddening of the body is a sign of superficial damage that does start to score in the higher categories of the ONE Championship criteria that we use here in ONE Hero Series.
Exerting a lot of energy as Yen, who's definitely trying to sway the judges' decision. Finishing strong here. These are big punches. Now he's starting to stand and put his whole body behind. He's getting more and more comfortable. Passing to half guard here.
Now he's starting to work. Now he's starting to pass. All he's got to do is get that right leg to pop through the line there. And you can see him getting heavy on the ground and pound.
Yang utilizing an underhook here, though that would be a great tool for him to get back to his feet, as he may do. If I was Yen or his corner, I'd be saying circle back into half guard and tie those hips up. Keep him flat on the ground. You don't need to worry about passing here.
Wow, how the tide has turned. Once the ground battle is initiated, Yen is all over Yang. Really put in a lot of good work here in the, what has it been, 3 minutes already?
Yeah, it was nearly 4 minutes of groundwork when we started this, so the time is counting down. This is a big round for Yen. Big knees, elbows, body work, head work. And you just see Yang Yang doesn't know what to do. He's just taking punishment here.
It's a good learning experience for Yang. You know, he's going to learn from this. I hope he grows from it. I hope he goes back to the drawing board, works on those escapes, because he's got a slick stand-up game.
Yeah, absolutely. And he had some great success earlier shutting down some of the takedowns, but just no success in this third round. That was a very, very good round for Yen.
Definitely one-way traffic here in ONE Hero Series. Here's some of the replays, and this is where it all got started for Yen and just the downfall of Yang.
A good knee, and then as we see, okay, here's an elbow here, and the relentless pressure of Yen as he comes forward, gets the ground and pound position really heavily, utilizing the elbows, the body work from head to body, kept him guessing the entire time, and this round was just an entire onslaught. And when you think that the bout is judged in its entirety, I mean, this was some of the most dominating, clearly dominating action of the entire bout.
And we go to the judges' scorecards, and they declare it a unanimous decision victory for Yan Xiyuan. Ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. We've got a lot more action coming to you from ONE Hero Series here in Shanghai, China. next in the bantamweight division is Wang Jingjie taking on Maimaitituoheti. Ladies and gentlemen, we are going the global rules set on this one. That's 3 5-minute rounds. Bout judged in its entirety. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent.
Guys, center.
In the red corner, coming out in the black and red shorts is Wang Jingjie. And in the blue corner, in the white trunks, is Maimaitituoheti. Referee John Lai getting us underway here.
Judge time.
In Shanghai, China.
Ready? Go!
Mitch Chilson alongside the world champion, Misha Tate. One hero series. We've got two very tough athletes getting it going. Ladies and gentlemen, the stakes could not be higher here at One Hero Series with the opportunity to get the call up to the big show. And just getting into one championship is a dream come true.
So both of these have wins, both these guys have wins in OHS, so they're looking to improve upon that. A big takedown here for Maimai. Right off the bat, I was impressed by his fake movement. He definitely wanted to feel out Wang and see what kind of a reaction was he going to get. You know, did Wang want to stand and strike, or was he going to pay respects to the fact that there was some movement towards the ground? And based off that read, Maimai decided to go in for his own takedown, but had me concerned there for a second. I thought maybe we would see a submission. Wang has a very active guard.
We've seen Maimaitituoheti before, and he has a very heavy top game. He likes to smother his opponents. He likes to work from their guard and just beat them up. And then Wang also has a very similar game plan. So these guys have very similar styles when it comes to, you know, getting their opponents to the ground and trying to control them and outwork them on the ground. You can see the high guard now from Wang as he's probably trying to tie up the arms, thinking
now
about maybe a submission.
Mitch, this could be really dangerous because you see he's on a pinpoint spot of his spine, which allows for a spinning motion. Those arm bars can come very quickly.
Action.
I would recommend to be careful for Maimai to lift his weight off the hips like that. He really could get himself in some trouble if Wang knows how to spin quickly to those submissions.
You can see the way he's tying up the arms. You know, he's trying to inch his guard a little bit higher, possibly looking for something there.
Absolutely. You're absolutely right there. He's inching his way up. He's trying to isolate those arms. And if he's got a good guard game here,
nice work.
This could be quite a precarious position for Maimai to allow himself to get extended in. As we see here, he's starting
to
transition.
Thinking about it, he's got the right arm tied up, might be looking for an arm bar.
Maimai doing a great job of slipping out of that. I imagine he's practiced being in that position a time or two before, passing to the half guard.
Prove your position.
Maimai's got a very heavy top game. He's very, very comfortable once he gets on top, as you can kind of see.
See there, Mitch, he's tying up that hand, even though momentarily, you know, it's just something else that Wang has to think about. Another obstacle in the road.
You can definitely see the experience. We're not seeing a lot of, you know, submission attempts, but you can see Wang is trying to set things up, like even just having that elevator hook there on that left side. He's trying to elevate the hips, create movement, might be looking for a possible ankle lock there. Or looking to get into an Ashigarami position where he tangles up the legs.
That's some good ground and pound in the mixture of that by Maimai.
Watch back ahead.
He's definitely working in some striking elements. Again, just trying to distract Wang from getting up.
Very close, stylistic battle. We've got the top game coming from Maimai versus the bottom game. Nice little spin to the guard pass there.
That
as he ends up on top. Beautiful transition as he's just floating around very well on top.
Yes, and then Wang finds his way up to a takedown. Not even any time spent on the feet, really.
beautiful job. These guys are engaging in a very intriguing ground battle. Both these guys are high-level grapplers.
This is very technical here. The way that they're passing the legs, the way that they're exchanging their body positions here. Good knees.
Maimai working that way back into half guard, it looks like he's got.
See, Maimai, he is really trying to stay on his side here. He knows that he doesn't want to be flat on his back. But Wang forcing him to do so. Not the position you want to be in to do something offensive.
But the way he cradled the leg there to kind of pin him in that position, he was controlling that right side of the hip, so Maimai wasn't able to pop back out.
And some quick scrambles going on here.
Oh, he
that might be
back.
A choke. That could be done. I know he doesn't have his hooks in, but he doesn't necessarily need to give up on that.
Wow, good scrambles by both these guys as he lands.
Finished by some knees and body work. Woo! Big punches.
Time. Back to your corner.
Nothing like a little flurry to end the round.
Wow, that was a pretty close round. I mean, the first half was definitely Maimai on top, but you know, you could see that, you know, Wang was starting to go for, he was attempting the submissions.
Yeah.
And then in the second half of the round, we started to see Maimai, you know, get a little bit outworked put on the ground as Wang.
Put it this
top.
Way, Mitch, I'm glad I don't have to judge this at this point, because I don't know who I would say is ahead, to be honest. I really don't.
Okay, let's put you on the spot. If you did have to score it, match was stopped right now, who do you got?
Oh my goodness, a draw.
There are no draws in one championship.
Well, this is why I'm a commentator and not a judge, Mitch. So I'll just tell you what's going on. They can tell you how it scores. This
Fair
one was
enough.
Too close for me, honestly. It really was. I guess it just depends what you favor, what you think is more credible. Even that flurry at the end, you know, there were some great knees and there was great punches by Maimai.
Ready? Go!
I really don't know.
Well, we'll let the athletes decide it then as we get underway here in the second round here at One Hero Series. Now, the opportunity to enter into the big show is on the line. The stakes could not be higher here in One Hero Series as we are coming to you live from Shanghai, China. And don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a huge card coming up tomorrow as Stamp Fairtex defends her atomweight Muay Thai title against the Australian champion, Alma. Yuniku.
There you go. Yeah, I know it's a hard one. I had to practice this week, trust me. But look, I have to point this out, Mitch, because this is highly entertaining to me. If you don't know what you're looking for here, Maimai is doing an excellent job of forcing Wang to give away his game plan. So watch. Maimai has been faking those shots and level changes here. He wants to see what Wang is going to do. I guess we're past that point at this point. Now we're into the clinch work, but it's highly fascinating for me to see the athletes trying to read each other on this level.
High pressure take clinch right here coming from Maimai as he's got that shoulder grinding in the chest, but good job from Wang to turn it around. Attempt to trip.
Attempt an inside trip, reversed by Maimai.
Nice little single leg as he turned the corner.
Scooting his butt, not really relentless to give up the takedown, but.
You can see him trying to defend as, you know, Wang was trying to circle around to secure side control. But I like how Maimai uses that hand to prevent him from securing the position as he dives around to take the back.
This is a. It's a 50-50 position, believe it or not. If Maimai could get that right arm back around and between both of them, he could stand up and face. However, Wang is still aggressively attacking for that back position. And the scramble does end up in Wang's favor here in side control. Again, looking to stay behind the hips now as this transitions.
Good job from Wang to secure the back in position. He likes that dive. He likes that roll through as he tries to sink in that choke a little bit. Again, he's trying to attempt the submission rather than the securing the position. But he's doing a good job of maintaining the position as you can see Maimai kind of going for a head scissors here.
Yeah, head scissor lock. Realized that probably was going to expend more energy than it was worth, letting it go. Trying to get back to the feet now is Mai Mai. Good job to bring the arm around. That's the arm that I was talking about, Mitch, about getting that between the two of them. Could be the saving grace here, but Wang is so close to getting that choke every time. It gets me a little bit excited thinking he may have it this time, but Mai Mai knows very well how to defend it. And he's able to get his back to the mat and reverse position here.
Yeah, if Wang was throwing up these submission attempts by a lesser grappler, he might have a submission victory already. But, you know, Mai Mai's doing a good job of just kind of keeping his composure, not allowing himself to be exposed and, you know, giving up a really bad position. Mai Mai controlling the top, drops a little bit of ground and pound as Wang digs for the underhook. Mai's trying to pass over into full mount now. Good job to secure the mount position.
Oh, those are heavy. Look at the hips. The way that they're just able to transition so flawlessly. And a good base here by Mai Mai. See how far apart his knees are? That just really makes it difficult for Wang to get any motion going, to get any kind of teeter-tottering wiggle room to get back to the feet. Oh, and a possible triangle here. Look, he's got one arm in, one arm out. If he locks those legs up here, he's pulling the head. He's trying to go for it. And Wang knew it.
Good defense from Wang to pull the hands in nice and tight to negate the possible triangle attempt. But Mai Mai is running away with this one at this point. He's got such good top control when he's on top. And the way he's striking, and he's finding these little openings to drop that ground and pound in.
Yeah, Mai Mai is fine not getting the submission, clearly. He wasn't that upset about it. He said, okay, while you're defending the triangle, I'm just going to punch you in the face.
He's doing a great job of it, the way he finds those openings.
And he tried that spinning guard pass again. Didn't work a second time on Wang.
Wang just turtles up.
Work to finish.
Mai Mai Tituoheti right now is really dominant in side control. The way he's got his legs spread out, controlling that far side hip, has good control of just kind of like that tabletop position, not allowing Wang to go anywhere as he finishes the round in a very dominant position.
Time. Back to your corners. Blue corner over here, Nantong.
Okay, now here we're going to look at a replay. So we got a big overhand right. That one had to sting a bit. And going for the takedown, but then I believe here, here's the story of the most of this round, is the top position and top control by Mai Mai. He's transitioning from side control to half guard to mount to back control. And he's also mixing in an onslaught of strikes as well, Mitch.
There's those strikes in between the transitions, and that's what makes a high-level mixed martial artist. If you're able to transition from the different elements of mixed martial arts, and he does it so beautifully by adding in the strikes as well.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Mitch. That's the evolution of the sport. It's not just who can do each category the best, but actually who can marry the categories together seamlessly. And I think that's really what I'm so impressed with by Mai Mai, is how willing and able he is to mix that together on the ground.
I'm so excited to watch these Chinese athletes because you never know what you're gonna get. You can get somebody that's trained in the Shaolin Kung Fu Temple and he's combat, or you get an Olympic wrestler, because China has such a diverse population of mixed martial artists that it's gonna be exciting to watch these guys grow. And we're right here on the forefront in One Hero Series, having the opportunity to showcase this talent from a country that has such a rich martial arts tradition like China.
Absolutely. And, you know, China's a pretty big place.
So I've heard.
I have yet to visit China, but I have a feeling now working for one championship. Oh. So we're here watching these athletes unfold some good action. I have yet to explore yet, I should say, in China.
Just living in the hotel. Got to see the Great Wall. Got to check out some of the sights out here. But beautiful Mai Mai throwing in the hands. Beautiful job to get inside the clinch. That's that transition to go from the punches to the grappling right into the ground game. Beautiful job by Mai Mai Tituoheti. You can see Wang's going back up to that high guard.
Mai Mai trying to back out of this. I'm so surprised that he brings his hips so high here, though. He's really susceptible to getting submitted. You see Wang trying to hook the leg to get some leverage.
I don't know if he fears the ground game of Wang. Like, he hasn't really been put in any deep submissions. I haven't heard the referee yell catch, so that means he hasn't quite gotten close to a submission. He hasn't even, he's come close. He's attempted a few
right.
of them.
And here he is in mount. So obviously you're right, Mitch. He knows that he has the advantage, or certainly believes he far outskills Wang on the ground.
You can just see that confidence that he's got inside that guard of Wang. He's not really fearing anything that's coming back his way. Good job by Maimai to get inside control. Now he's throwing a little bit of knees, just continuing to soften up Wang here on the ground.
All right, so transition to back here. Wang just seems frustrated. He's not really able to move under the pressure of Maimai. You see him going from the turtle position to the guard position, back to the turtle position, but he's not finding any real success in these transitions. Trying to get back to his feet, Wang. And just as I say that, back to the feet.
Outside trip attempt there by Maimai. As looks like Wang attempted to step over there, possibly go for a judo throw. See, Maimai just relentlessly pushing forward, gets the trip again, and we are back on the mat. What does Wang have to do here? Is he? He's probably behind at this point. Does he have to finish to get the win?
Well, I would say so. I think after the accumulation of the second round and how the third round's going, that's what I would suspect the corner to think, and the judges are probably scoring this now pretty heavily in the favor of Maimai. Back position, look at him getting his hooks in. Now we haven't really seen Maimai establish his hooks on the back here. I'm curious what he can do from this position.
Yeah, you can start to see Wang starting to turtle up. He's, you can see him there at the end of the second round, how he just kind of dove into the turtle position.
Reset.
I think the referee is going to reset them back to the center of the ring. And it looks like Maimai was in full mount.
So a quick break in the action to reset. Making sure the athletes stay inside the ring.
Go!
This could be it. This might be Maimai's opportunity.
The grounded pound from these positions, from mount and the back particularly. Now look at this. Maimai hasn't totally extended and flattened out. Either way he goes, he's sustaining tremendous damage. Huge elbows.
Finish.
The 30 seconds of work, that could be enough time here. He's got those hips locked down, Mitch. And it's over.
Oh, wow. Beautiful finish. My. Really elevating his game. Every single round, he found another gear to finally get the win here in One Hero Series. Misha, talk us through this one.
So here, Wang is just trying anything he can do to get in a different position to escape, but giving up the back was not the one he needed to go for, because Maimai was able to essentially lock those hips into place. Wang had nowhere to go, and the onslaught of punches just were not going to stop until the referee had to intervene. That was a beautiful finish.
Referee John Lai jumping in to stop the onslaught coming from Maimaitituoheti as he has announced the victor here in the third round. I don't think you can get much closer to that. Ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. We still got some huge matchups coming your way at One Hero Series in Shanghai, China.
This is our journey. This is our mission. All of the places, all of the people, all of the smiles, the prayers, the late nights, the preparation. All of the sweat and tears. It's the match of our lives. It's our dedication to greatness. This is our world. This is our stage.
And there it is! How does that mean? Come on! Good night! I three! Oh, it's turning back and crossing! How about this? Enzo Gracie's back!
Touchdown! She's done it! Angela Lee!
This crowd's going bananas! Oh, here
it comes! And it is all over!
Is this the time? Is this the moment?
The roar around me is
one.
Coming up next in the flyweight division is a mixed martial arts contest between Hu Yong and Huyixibai. Ladies and gentlemen, we are going to go the global rule set on this one. It's 3 5-minute rounds, bout judged in its entirety, not round by round. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent, no spiking or suplexing on the head, neck, or spine. In the red corner is Hu Yong, in the red, white, and blue trunks. And in the blue corner is Huyixibai.
Judge, time, ready, go!
Huyixibai coming out in the blue corner in the white trunks is a wrestler with a very good stand-up game, and Hu Yong comes to us out of the Fighting Brothers Club and is extremely well-versed in Sanda.
All right, so some a little bit of feeling out action here. Some leg kicks coming from Hui early on. Ooh, and already going for a head kick.
I like the way he's going for that left high kick. There's no setup, but a big right hand.
And Hu is on him.
Hu Yong is dropping the bombs down on
Hui, trying to get his marbles back a little bit here. That definitely rattled the cage.
Huyixibai is trying to get his wits about him, as Misha said there.
And well recovered.
He ate a huge flurry of shots, but he gets right back on top to secure the mount position. Hu's got to work back up to his feet. Hui takes the back, locks in the body triangle.
That's a great technique to just put so much pressure on the diaphragm. It makes it hard to breathe, and it's really difficult to change position from there for the person who's in that body triangle. And you see Hui chipping away at Hu with those little punches. But really, Mitch, those are just distractions because he wants to choke here. He's looking for a submission, whether it be an armbar or a choke. He's trying to create distraction. Here you see him feeding under the neck here.
He's a little bit too high there on the back, though. He's kind of reaching down to sink in that choke.
Yeah, great point, Mitch. You know, that's because the body triangle there kind of allows you to stay a little bit higher on the body. Perhaps if he were to sink down a little bit, he'd have a little bit more real estate with those arms to actually get down under the chin.
Would he give up the body triangle to get the choke, or is he just okay to just eat up the clock and beat him up here?
I mean, that's really athlete preference, to be honest. He's just riding a little bit higher because of the body triangle. And once you lock that in, you don't really slide. As you know, Mitch, you don't really move around much, so he just happens to have it a little bit higher on the waist, making that rear naked choke a little bit more difficult, but doing a great job of softening up the body, softening up the action.
He's distracting by going to the body, and then he's trying to work his way up to the choke. He chooses to abandon the body triangle. Again, looking to sit in the mount, but you know, you can see Hu trying to scramble, trying to create a little bit of movement, but Hui is all over him.
You see, once that body triangle is locked, and he's just stuck in that position, which he's obviously very comfortable in. It's definitely not a bad thing, but there's just not much movement. Now, what really what Hu needs to do is get that locked up side down to the mat where he can start to use his lower body to loosen that. And you see, as soon as the body triangle opened up, well, we have some movement.
Huyixibai created, oh, he almost opened it up for him as Hu spun around, ended up in guard. Now we get to see the handiwork here again of Hu. Look for that right hand. That's what did the damage in that first minute.
Good luck by Hui. Spinning attacks. Now Hu is just really lunging forward because he had so much success in that first exchange, but he's got to be careful doing that because if Hu is able to get underneath it, he's going to get that takedown again.
Hu Yong's got a beautifully timed right hand, but now we're starting to see again, he threw it again as he caught the leg kick there.
Nice. Oh, and a good uppercut. What a nice three-piece, Mitch.
Yeah, with a side of fries and a drink. Beautifully touched up the face there of Huyixibai. Nice little timing there as he evaded the spin kick to come back with a left hand. Hu's got some serious talent on his feet.
Time.
Looks like he opened him up there with one of those punches.
Yeah, I'm going to take a look, quick look at Hui to just make sure that he is safe to continue. Always worried about athlete safety first here at One Hero Series.
Hu Yong is definitely pumped up trying to get himself back into this after he spent about 3 minutes on the ground getting outworked. Looks like he's had a little bit of a cut on Huyixibai's, I think it was right eye? Possibly from the left hand thrown by Hu Yong. Interesting first round. Tough to score. Tough to score. Should I put Misha Tate on the spot?
Oh, I really hate having to score these sometimes because you're just thinking, like, you don't really. I mean, there's depends what angle you look at it, Mitch. I mean, there was some great action on the feet. It was great action on the ground as well. I mean, I think if we have to score monumental moments, it's been close on the feet. I think there's been some good exchanges from both. But I think Hui is running away with this so far, but there's a lot of time on the clock. So I hate to really put too much weight on it so early in the bout.
Looks like Huyixibai is good to continue as they wipe him off. But with a cut right there, and that's a very precarious position. It's gonna flow down into this eye, it's gonna affect his sight, so he's gotta have a little bit of urgency here. Nice jab landed by Hu Yong.
Yeah, that's one thing I never had happen in a bout. I was never cut before, so I don't know how distracting it can be. Mitch, have you?
Really? You've never been cut?
I've never been cut.
Look at my eyes. I'm filled with scar tissue. And
so tell me then, if you wipe your face and you're like, oh, I'm bleeding, does that factor in, or you just kind of?
It does. Yeah. It really does. And it also affects your opponent, too. He sees that red. It's like a shark in the water. You hunt after it. Good first round from both these guys. Let's break down some of the action we saw in the first round.
It's a replay of a big right hand. That one wobbled Hui, and another big right hand to land. As you see, ground and pound followed up there as well. Nice leg kick by Hu. Caught though by Hu, and again he's trying to follow up with those great strikes that he found so much success with in the early part of the round.
Yeah, Hu Yong on the feet is doing damage with that big right hand, but then when things hit the ground, Huyixibai is all over it, controlling the back, so it's going to come down to who has the better strategy. In the corner right now, Hu Yong, what are you telling him?
I would tell him to find a home for the jab first and be a little bit patient. Maybe come with that onslaught of striking after you've stuffed the initial shot. You know, just to not get overzealous with it, not get carried away and give up your hips and get taken down.
How does Huyixibai deal with that? How does he get the takedown? How does he get close enough to get that?
Well, here you see he's got great head movement. That's one thing, getting inside that, trying to dodge the jab hand. And just a matter of timing, really. You see a little bit of taunting from Hu, saying, yeah, give me a little more. I'm all right, I can take that. That usually means it hurts, though, homage.
That's usually what it does. It lets him know you got it. You can see the reddening start to develop there on the left leg there as Hu Yong looks to get on top.
Wow, I think that was a mental switch for Hu when he started to taunt him a little bit with that leg kick. You know, it's just he turned a mental switch that, hey, I'm here. I have, you know, come at me and you'll see what you're going to get. We're definitely seeing more pressure.
What we see from Hu Yong is like in the breaks, in those gaps between the striking exchanges, he creates those openings and he finds those little holes. Huyixibai is trying to take control of the center ring, and he lands a nice little overhand right there.
He's, you know, Hui's doing a good job of getting in and out at the moment. He's landed two solid punches and then evaded the follow-up shots by Hu Yong. Those leg kicks, you know, it's not something we've been focusing on too much, but if he keeps landing those, I mean, you know, Mitch, how that can really slow the forward pressure and forward pace shooting ability of Huyi.
That's what I'd like to see him do more of, because Hu Yong's got really good lateral movement. He's constantly putting pressure. If Huyixibai can start to touch up that leg and really start to dig into it. Right now, he's kind of leaning back when he throws the leg kick to avoid the right hand, the counter from Hu Yong. So if he kind of digs in a little bit more, sinks his weight into that leg kick, it's going to start to have a little bit more power to it, and he can start to connect with the shin.
As you can see right there, you see the reddening just around the corner of the leg, around the back side. And it'll start to pool with blood a little bit there. It'll start to stiffen up, and it just makes it essentially harder to move with the speed and accuracy that we've been seeing from Hu Yong so far.
Ready, ready, go!
So this is the third time we have seen Hu Yong with good reason, because that right hand is something beautiful. Right now he is 2-0. He is undefeated in one hero series. And Huyixibai is trying to stop the rolling of Hu Yong.
Yeah, it could be, you know, winning a third bout on one hero series. That makes a pretty strong case for a slot on the one championship roster, wouldn't you say, Mitch?
Yeah, you know, he gets to join the ranks of, you know, Hanzi Hao, the current strawweight queen, you know, Zhong Jingna. So we definitely are, we have a lot of room on this packed one championship roster for high level talent like Hu Yong.
Got to be careful here, though. And wow, yeah, what a great job defending these. Good quick knee by Hui.
Great balance from Huyixibai. He is a veteran. He does have a record of 11-3, so he's definitely got a lot of experience, while Hu Yong's just 4-1, so he's going to try to lean on that experience and take Hu Yong into those later parts of the third round.
Hu Yong has such good lateral movement. It's like he plants here, but then he moves left and right so good. Oh, and that was a vicious uppercut, just barely missing. Hu Yong's obviously looking to time that uppercut, though, as Huyi clearly probably wants to shoot again at some point in this.
But you can see it's a good weapon to choose to use, because
Huyi just landed it.
He leans forward. He really commits by tucking his chin in and dropping that head down as he gets a double leg.
That was a great wrestling exchange. Lots of hip transitions here. Huyi does find his way into the half guard position. Probably taking a moment here to catch his breath. That was quite a bit of energy expend, but does not want to sit idle for too long, because Hu Yong has a lot left to offer. Looking to probably get back to his feet if there's any release of pressure.
This is what Hu Yong needed to do, Huyixibai needed to do. He needed to slow down that striking of Hu Yong and really start to wear on Hu Yong, because Hu Yong was starting to touch him up and run away with this one. But now, you know, Huyixibai is starting to show that veteran experience that he's got.
So he did get him down, but he hasn't been able to do a whole lot with it.
What?
And this is where these scorecards, where it gets interesting, because you wonder, you know, how much the position versus the striking and all that will actually come into play.
Good scrambling there from Hu Yong. Now we do score.
And a big right hand to exit that exchange there.
You can see him again. He's trying with that uppercut. He times that thing right. Right as Hu Yixibai is starting to lean forward. We're starting to see that cut really start to open up, and that is damage. That is our highest scoring category. You know, striking superiority and ground control, that's kind of like, those are equal things in our scoring criteria. But then you get into the damage category, superficial damage, eternal damage, and that's when the scoring starts to mount up. And that's that beautiful right hand again landed by Hu Yong.
And once again there, that's definitely finding a home and leaving some damage for Hui to wear in this bout.
Now, Misha Tate, I know we're not judges. We just pretend to be them on TV. But how do you have this match so far?
You know, at this point, I think I'm going to say that Hu Yong is running away with this. I think that those exchanges on the feet, the damage that he's been able to inflict, and you know, he just looks so polished. He looks so good on the feet, and he shut down most of those takedowns. I know that Hui did get a takedown in that round, but I just think that he wasn't able to do enough with it to sway my opinion of how this bout is going so far.
There you have it, ladies and gentlemen, the opinion of the world champion, Misha Tate. And if you don't know who this young lady is, you have got to Google her, because her matches are something special. And we are underway in the third and final round of this flyweight tilt between two very hungry Chinese prospects out here in One Hero Series, as Hui Shibai tries to go for a double leg, but it's stopped again by Hu Yong.
Hu Yong is finding his timing, he's finding his range, and you see he's finding that home for that jab. He doesn't. He's not rushing forward too much. He rushes forward for like a couple steps, and then he pauses just to make sure he can catch the takedown, successfully defend it, then he goes back to striking. It's a work of art. It's beautiful.
Shibai still got that pressure. He's still controlling the center of the ring, but Hu Yong is just touching him up at every opportunity he gets.
Yeah, it was a good quick knee by Hui. Good shot. Again. Well
but
defended.
The hips of Hu Yong. Beautiful timing on that sprawl. Because it looked like it was academic. Hui Shibai was nice and deep. He had his hands locked.
Yeah, he didn't just sprawl, though. I mean, he really inverted his hips to stop any forward pressure of Hui. And then from there, successfully dug those underhooks, got a good break. And now looking to implement this flawlessly timed striking.
I like the spins to the overhand right, but then he missed that, and then he came back again with a nice little right slip through the guard. As these guys are starting to get a little bit wild here in the third and final round.
Both these guys want this so bad. This is one of those matches, Mitch, where I hate to qualify anyone as a loser, because they are going at it, and they really understand what's on the line here, what opportunity it needs to win here tonight.
Especially with Hu Yong, who's so close. He's already 2-0. You know, if Hui Shibai gets a victory over Hu Yong, that's a huge stepping stone for him.
And he does get the takedown here. I would think he should have a sense of urgency.
Yeah, he's got to do something with this. I don't know if he's got enough, you know, scoring in his back pocket to really put forth. He just kind of grinds out of this,
it.
You know, decision here. He needs a victory. He needs a big emphatic submission, or at least do some big damage. Good job by Hu Yong to elevate the hips to create the scramble.
Digging underhooks here. Good job to bring this back to the standing position by Hu Yong. Definitely looking to disengage. Hu Yi trying to hang on. Hu Yi doesn't want any space here. He wants to get this back to the ground.
Yeah, that's his best opportunity. I mean, it is, you know, mixed martial arts, and it is a box of chocolates, and anything can happen. Ain't that right, Misha Tate? But right now, if it goes to the judges' scorecards, Hu Yong might be running away with it. Looks like he got poked in the eye. Got to be careful. Defend yourself at all times.
That is true. You cannot look to the referee and say, hey, save me. you know, a good job on Huyi's part, though, to not stop in that situation. I mean, you absolutely should not until the referee tells you to do so. Mistake by Hu Yong to say referee, step in.
Yeah, that's hard to keep that, you know, that instinct alive to keep pushing forward when your opponent raises your hand. If your opponent raises your hand, you're like, oh, okay, what's wrong? Good killer instinct shown by Huyixibai to keep that pressure on him.
He was definitely able to get some of the best strikes off of the round.
Yeah.
Right there in that exchange.
Let's not bring that up.
Had Hu Yong just kind of moving off yonder.
But this definitely, I think this could be, as he lands a nice little left hand there. These guys are exchanging.
You hear that? The impact.
Oh, big slam there. Now you got to be careful. You are not allowed to suplex on the head, neck, or spine. And Huyixibai took Hu Yong for the ride as he planted him with a beautiful belly-to-back suplex. But you can't do that.
Well, that's unfortunate because that was pretty cool, but we definitely don't want to, you know, do anything that's illegal or dangerous. So that's unfortunate. Do you think he would have had that submission, Mitch? It looked like he was under the neck there, but you got to play by the rules.
No suplexing on the head, neck, or spine. And athlete safety is our number one priority as Hu Yong got dumped on his head. There's one championship referee, Olivier Cost, making sure Hu Yong is okay. Hu Yong. So if the match, you can see it right here, slips around to the back, and here we go.
Goes for a big ride, and that does. He tries to rotate through, though. It kind of lands on the shoulder there from the angle that I can see. Maybe we get this from another angle here.
This might be a better angle.
You know, Hui did try to rotate through. See, watch the rotation change. He tried to change here. He didn't try to throw slam
him. Oh, the rope.
Just out of view, that's a little bit difficult to say.
Oh, it looks like
this may be a red card,
oh,
Mitch.
Oh, the red card comes out of the pocket. Huyixibai has been disqualified for an illegal technique of a suplex to the head of Hu Yong.
Oh, that's so unfortunate.
It is illegal to suplex on the head, neck, or spine. A fighter's athlete safety is our number one priority, and Huyixibai gets disqualified in a very entertaining matchup, and Hu Yong remains undefeated here in One Hero Series, extending his record to 5-1, as I believe referee Kemp Chang is going to make an official decision here.
Nobody wants to win like that,
yeah,
though.
That's not
so
the way
unfortunate.
You win, especially after such a match.
Match. I almost forgot that was.
Stan Fairtex versus Alma Judiku for the Anamite Muay Thai world title.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are halfway through our stacked card here in One Hero Series, but don't go anywhere because we've got some incredible matchups, including the last match of the night against Fu Qing Nan and Liu Wei. It is gonna be a big matchup. Kickboxing rules on that one. You don't wanna miss it. But coming up next in the welterweight division, the big boys are here in a mixed martial arts rules contest. We've got Wurigenbayar taking on Kurbanjiang. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the global rule set on this one. We are going to go 5 3-minute rounds, bout judged in its entirety, not round by round. No spiking or suplexing on the head, neck, or spine. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen, in the welterweight division. In the blue corner is Kurbanjiang, and in the red corner is Wurigenbayar.
Here.
Referee Olivier Cost.
Hold back over here. Low blow. Yeah. And back, okay? Check it in if you want. Back your corner.
Getting started right, judge, in the welterweight division.
Time. Ready? Ready? Chok!
In the black trunks is Kurbanjiang, and in the red and black trunks is Wurigenbayar. Regan's trying to control that center cage, stomping on the leg there of Kurbanjiang.
Kurbanjiang is light on the feet. A lot of bouncing, trying to disguise any timing. However, Regan seems to have found it already.
Regan looks gigantic. Looks like this beautiful right hand as he caught the kick there.
Wow.
Oh, he's done.
Just maybe done. Quickest finish of the night. That was impressive. Making short work.
Wurigenbayar. Wow. Wurigenbayar caught the kick, landed a huge right hand. That's what hurt him. And then he jumped all over him, landing that big ground and pound.
Yeah, let's take a look at this. So here, he caught the leg kick, landed a big right hand, passed the legs, the defense there. He kept passing those legs by and then slamming those hammer fists down. What a fast, vicious knockout victory here. Passing those legs, so smartly done there. You see how he keeps shifting those legs through so that he can get past the defense and land those hammer kicks. One last look at this. We're gonna show him shifting those legs by. Watch here as he spins, shifts those legs by again, dropping those great hammer fists.
I control that leg, he never let go of the leg. Yep. He always was in control of it, so there was no chance for Kurbanjiang to get back into guard. Beautifully done.
Just kept redirecting that defense.
Winner.
Beautifully done in the red corner. Huge win for Egan. Coming away in the very first round by TKO. Don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. One Hero Series will be coming back with more action in just a moment's time.
This is our journey. This is our mission. All of the places. All of the people. All of the smiles. The prayers. The late nights. The preparation. All of the sweat and tears. It's the match of our lives. It's our dedication to greatness. This is our world. This is our stage.
And there it is! How does that mean? Come on! Good night! 5-3! Oh, it's turning back to Chong! How about this? Enzo Gracie's back!
Touchdown! She's done it! Angela Lee!
This crowd's going bananas! Oh, there
he comes! And it is all over!
Is this the time? Is this the moment?
The roar around me is...
is won.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back, and now we are going to the bantamweight division. Mixed martial arts on this one. We've got Zhong Qing Ya taking on Ahejiang. This is going to be a big matchup. We're going to go the global rule set on this one. That's 3 5-minute rounds, bout judged in its entirety, not round by round. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent. No spiking or suplexing on the head, neck, or spine.
Watch out for headbutt.
Referee Olivier Koss getting us started in the bantamweight division in the white trunks. We've got Ahejiang taking on Zhong Qing Ya.
Judge time. Ready? Ready?
This is going to be a good one. We've seen both these guys here. And Ahejiang trying to close that distance, coming out in that karate stance. And we've seen Zhong Qing Ya before. He's taking on Kevin Chung out there in Myanmar in one championship. So now he's made his way into one hero series. Trying to work his way back up to the big show.
Zhong trying to find a place for that, a home for that leg kick early. Lots of spinning attacks here early on.
Ahejiang's kind of got that karate style. He's got that wide stance, the low guard. He's starting to spin. Zhong Qing Ya's got a good grappling pedigree, so I'd like to see him try to take this to the ground, because Ahejiang's piecing him up right now on his feet.
Ahejiang's kind of got this sort of a karate style, I would say, stance. And he is using that here. Good reversal. Good top position.
Ahejiang's on top right now. Got his hands nice and tight to his body. You can Zhong trying to control the head, trying to keep him nice and tight. Ahejiang's trying to smother him, stay on top, create a little bit of space, trying to frame off that head right now. Zhong's,
we have a potential catch here. And he still has the arm locked up, though. He still has that arm locked up, and now he's transitioning to the back. A lot of submissions were just threatened there in a few seconds, Mitch. Oh, but we now out here, Zhong going for transition to the back. He had a potential guillotine there, but decided maybe that position before submission was a better idea.
Ahejiang, he's trying to control the back. He's got that knee.
Watch
out. You can see the way he's got that leg laced up. He's trying to control that opposite side. Ahejiang, now he is actually undefeated. He's never lost in a mixed martial arts contest.
Wait, he has a head and arm, but he didn't decide to go for that. Interesting.
Just negate the submission attempt there, but this Ahejiang's very slick on the ground too.
Very slick. Both are realistically, but Ahejiang is really establishing all the dominant positions in these exchanges. But Zhong's giving him a good run for his money, just not able to beat him to the position here.
Zhong's competitive, he's moving with him, but Ahejiang's just one step ahead. He comes from a wrestling background, but we're not really seeing that type of wrestling style. He's got a very fluid, sort of all-encompassing mixed martial arts style.
Big punches coming here from Ahejiang. And looking to flatten out Zhong here. This is a nasty position. We saw this earlier in the night. This can definitely be a bout-ending position here. Those hips get locked out, and there's just really nowhere to go. An onslaught of rights and lefts. A very demoralizing position, Mitch, to be in.
Look at that. He's just got the hips flattened him out right now, and he's dropping the bomb. He's trying to stay accurate. He's going with that side sort of hammer fist right there. Zhong's got to move. That's about it. Huge win to remain undefeated. Ahejiang.
Making a case tonight for a slot on the one championship roster, Mitch.
That is a pretty emphatic victory to announce his arrival in the bantamweight division. Look at these side sort of
look
shots
how
that he's
throwing.
Doing.
It's like the bottom of his fist, you know. He's really getting this kind of whipping factor. I can't say that I've ever seen this style, Mitch. He's not trying to throw with the knuckles, really. He's using a whipping motion to really create It's a lot of torque on those.
He's skipping rocks.
Well, yeah. He's just skipping punches off of a head instead.
And the way he celebrates afterwards, I like
and
this
And a good
guy.
Display of sportsmanship. I saw him go over and give a hug to his opponent. Always like to see that.
Big win out of the blue corner. Ahejiang, Ailinuer. Big win coming in the bantamweight division. Ladies and gentlemen, we got a lot more action coming up in One Hero Series. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned. Contest. We've got Liu Jun taking on Zhong Xu Kui in a kickboxing contest. We're going to go the global rule set on this one. That's 3 3-minute rounds. 10-point must system is in effect. 3 knockdowns in a round equals a TKO. No elbows, throws, or grappling. We've got a kickboxing contest, ladies and gentlemen, with small gloves. These are two highly experienced kickboxers in the red corner, in the orange and black. We've got Liu Jun, and in the blue corner, we have Song Shi Kui. I believe Song Shi Kui has his name written across his trunk. That makes it even easier to identify that young man.
Ready?
We always have to have a laugh, but the names are the most difficult part for us here. Giving you guys good commentary here. We're working on it. We're working.
We got two Americans in the booth, so you guys got to cut us some slack. Nice little left hook combination to that leg kick coming from Liu. And Song tries to parry the push kick out. Nice 1-2 combination landed by Liu Jun as Song tries to skip kick into that one.
Yeah, blocked by Liu though.
Spinning wheel kick attempted by Song. Can't quite find the range. It's almost the linear attacks of Liu versus the wide angled shots of Song.
I'm always amazed when you put small gloves on these incredible strikers. The kickboxing, the Muay Thai guys that are featured here sometimes. Just so incredible to watch.
Stop!
You the strike techniques there. With
ladies and gentlemen, if you are a fan like Misha Tate is of high-level kickboxing and small gloves, you are definitely going to want to tune in tomorrow night. We've got some stellar kickboxing matches on tap for tomorrow in Shanghai. But right now, we've got a good tilt on our hands. And Song's trying to find that range, trying to find the distance. Liu's pushing forward, attacks to the body, goes low with the leg kick.
Yeah, good mixing it up on Liu's part. He's moving between the body, between the head, between the legs, mixing it up.
Liu Jun in the red corner is 20-9 in his kickboxing career.
Just barely missing that.
And Song Shi Kui is 59-9 in his kickboxing career.
Did you hear that three-piece?
I did, and it sounded tasty. These guys are long, lengthy athletes trying to find that range, trying to get nice and tight. You can see Liu's trying to push forward. Song's got a beautiful counter striking. Landed a nice little three. I like that left hook, leg kick combination thrown by Liu. It's landing.
That was a big right hand, followed by a big kick there by Liu. Finding a home for these strikes in the finishing seconds of this first round.
Stop!
Hey.
Go.
See Song trying to work inside of that clinch. Now they are allowed to clinch, but it's only for 3 seconds, so they got to get in, do a little bit of work, and then let go.
Stop.
And move on to the next counter.
And there's got to be continuous action too.
It's got to be continuous. The clinch has got to be offensive. And referee Atsushi Onari is letting them know that they cannot clinch for that long. Liu was trying to go for the stop and slap there as he went whipping right by him.
Good little head kick. It was more of a slapping, but definitely let him know that it's a threat.
Now we're going to go the 10-point must system on this one, ladies and gentlemen. So that means the winner of the round gets 10, while the loser of the round, depending upon how effective they are, gets 9 or less. Scoring that one, Miss Misha Tate. How do you have it?
You know, I think that Liu did a little bit more. I think the mixing up the exchanges on that one to the head, to the body, I think he was just a little bit more clean with those. I think he landed a little bit more of the combinations.
And ladies and gentlemen, you are correct. Don't let it fool you. That is the voice of the world champion, the woman's pioneer, and now vice president of ONE Championship, Misha Tate, joining me in the booth for tonight's ONE Hero Series. As Liu Jun takes on Zhong, Xie Kui. Good movement there. He's starting to see Song trying to stay light on his feet. You know he's trying to attempt that spinning. He loves that spinning wheel kick. You can see him take flight, constantly mixing up those attacks.
Oh!
Beautiful right hand landed by
that
Liu
was
Jun.
The one.
Six.
Standing 10 count.
Eight.
He has 10
Nine.
Seconds.
Okay.
That was enough. That was the one that took home the victory for Liu.
Wow, what
so we're gonna
a
look
right
at a replay.
Hand. Liu was patient. He was waiting for that moment to present himself right here off the leg kick right over the top.
He was able to time that in the half. See, we saw a left hook coming here, but he was able to cut that off and answer that with an extremely powerful right hand to end the entire bout, Mitch.
Wow, the walk-off KO. Huge win, improving his record to 21-9. Victor out of the red corner, Liu Jun. Ladies and gentlemen, we still got action coming your way, going back to the mixed martial arts category, coming up next.
Vertex versus Alma Judiku for the Anamite Muay Thai world title.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's Legendary Quest tomorrow night, but up next in the flyweight division in ONE Hero Series is a mixed martial arts contest between Xie Wei taking on Liu Deligerihu. And the global rule set on this one is 3 5-minute rounds, bout judged in its entirety, not round by round, no kicks to the head of a grounded opponent, no spiking or suplexing on the head, neck, or spine. In the blue corner, we've got a flyweight matchup. In the blue corner, we've got Liu Deligerihu taking on Xie Wei in the red corner. Liu is coming in the green trunks. He comes from a wrestling background, a Mongolian wrestling background. He is a champion out there in China. And Xie Wei comes, actually, Xie Wei has a very interesting story. He comes from the Shaolin Temple. He studied out there at the Shaolin Temple, studying Kung Fu, and fell in love with mixed martial arts. So we've got a Kung Fu striker taking on a wrestling champion. This is going to be a good one, Miss Misha Tate.
I'm always excited for these. Love good classic matchups. Starting heavy. Good right hand to land off the bat. Absolutely no feeling process, feeling out process from these two. Beautiful takedown by C.
Nice little trip there by Xie Wei as he ends up in side control here. Liu's got to start scrambling. He's got to start moving. Good job on the adjustment of hand. Look at he's driving that shoulder into the chin there, trying to turn his head away so he can't escape out. But Liu's trying to get in. He's got to deal with that underhook on that one, on that left side. He's got to try to get that underhook. Which is, now he's just secured the overhook.
Now CE is in a great position here to drop those elbows. Yeah, you see as he's keeping that pressure with that forearm and also the underhook here. That's key. That is absolutely key. He has the control as long as he has that far side underhook.
You see him trying to frame off that head, but a good job by Liu to try to bury his head into the stomach there to avoid any shots. But just that framing off, that constant pushing from Xie. Doing a good job of controlling the exchange here in the ground. Oh, elbow.
Xie landing some good knees, followed up by those busy punches. Oh, he's looking to trap that arm there. Now this is what we call a crucifix position. If he's able to lock both arms in place, there's absolutely no way for Liu to defend. Liu feeling that sense of urgency to get out of that. Nice scramble by Liu.
Good job by Xie Wei on a top position. I was wrong calling him just a kung fu striker, but the Shaolin Temple got me a little bit excited because this guy is a well-rounded mixed martial artist.
Well, now he's been doing this since he's 14. I mean, he's been training martial arts, landing a lot of punches here, and able to stay in dominant position. This may be it.
That's a tap due to strikes right there. Xie Wei, welcome to One Hero Series.
Liu protesting a bit there, saying it looked like he was signaling to the back of the head there, but I didn't really catch any illegal blows, so I just think the pressure really was getting to him too much. Yeah. Let's look at the replay here. So we have Xie transitioning to the back there, throwing those good punches. Yeah, no, he's good. Those are all legal punches. Those are all landing, at least touching the ear. That's the general rule, that part of the glove has to connect with the ear. Those were all legal.
Yeah, it looked like he was actually trying to tap or at least think about it possibly, but a huge win out of the red corner from Xie Wei by TKO stoppage in the very first round. Ladies and gentlemen, we've still got the big one of the night, a kickboxing matchup in the final match here at One Hero Series. So don't go anywhere. You do not want to miss this one. Ladies and gentlemen, in the final match of the night, we are gonna go kickboxing in the bantamweight division. We've got the return of Fu Qing Nan taking on Liu Wei. This is gonna be a big matchup. Kickboxing global rule set, it's 3 3-minute rounds, 10-point must system is in effect. 3 knockdowns in a round equal to TKO, no elbows, throws, or grappling. You can clinch, but it's got to be for a minimum of 3 or a maximum of 3 seconds, and the action has got to be continuous. Referee Atsushi Onari getting ready to get us started as our athletes are making their way into the ring.
I always think what's going through the athletes' minds as they make the walk. You know, I've asked that question so many times, and I feel like everyone's answer is different.
What was yours?
You know, and it changed throughout my career. I don't know if that's similar for you, Mitch, but, you know, different at different points, you know, I always would feel like I'm kind of getting ready to do something that I absolutely love, you know, that I love to do. So you have to, like, get in that mindset that you're getting ready for battle. And I feel like things simplify, right? You just go into, like, this tunnel vision and you have a mission to do. And it's like you have to turn that pressure into something positive, right? I mean, what was your mindset going out there?
I was terrified.
You're just looking at me like I'm crazy.
Out of my mind going in there. But this is going to be a big matchup. We've got a great, exciting kickboxing matchup. We have seen Fu Qing Nan before. We've seen him on multiple occasions, and he is highly entertaining. He comes out, and he has beautiful technique, and he's got such great movement. His opponent is definitely something special, so this is going to be a good matchup between two serious knockout artists. We've got the king, we've got the Dragon King going up against the King of the Knockouts. So this is going to be an interesting one here.
So this is essentially the kings. This is a bout between the kings.
It's a battle for the throne here in Shanghai, China. Who will leave with the crown and the scepter? Ladies and gentlemen, don't forget, we've got a huge matchup card coming tomorrow night, Legendary Quest. We've got the return of Stamp Vertex as she takes on a very worthy challenger, and it's going to be an exciting matchup. We've got the return of Akiyama. He's coming back after a four-year layoff to take on Augie Lantani.
His debut,
but next, we've got this exciting kickboxing matchup.
No cringe. Okay. Take on.
Here we go, referee Atsushi Onari getting us started. We're going three-minute rounds. Kickboxing rules in little gloves.
I can't get enough of that. Kickboxing in small gloves, it's brilliant. It leads to so much good action.
See, Liu Wei coming out in the southpaw stance. He's a little bit taller than Fu Qing Nan. Fu Qing Nan's got beautiful movement. He's got exceptional combos. We've seen him on numerous occasions here in One Hero Series. But Liu Wei is a long, lengthy bantamweight.
You see, it's typical of an orthodox and southpaw stance to kind of tap those front gloves. You see that they're tapping, because they're really trying to get the timing and over the top of each other's lead hands. So those lead hands, it's a very technical battle to get the position.
Wow, look at those sounds of those exchanges, just the thuds on top of the head. It sounds like taking a baseball bat to a watermelon.
Go!
Fu Qing Nan scores a knockdown here in the first round, so automatically it's going to be a 10-8 round if it does go that far, as Fu Qing Nan scores the first knockdown of the round. Three knockdowns in a round equals a TKO.
Landing another solid jab there, as you see the head of Louis pop back, absorbing that damage.
Nice inside leg kick landed by Fu Qing Nan.
Look at the intensity on the look of Fu's face. He's just analyzing, just like a computer, just taking in every measurement that he needs to calculate exactly where to land.
Fu Qing Nan has a record of 34-9, while his opponent Liu Wei has a kickboxing record of 31-11. So both these guys, very experienced strikers.
Fight!
I still think Louis is trying. Liu is trying to get his senses back a little bit. Fu is not giving him any time to do so.
Man, Fu landed some beautiful combinations there. You can see how the you can see Liu trying to cover up, trying to defend, but the little gloves, they don't give you that same opportunity, right?
They don't, but that's what leads to so much more action. There's just less padding around the hands, so you can't bring them up to your face and expect them to cover much. The little gloves have a way of finding big head kick by Fu, but those little gloves have a way of finding their way, navigating through each other. You cannot block the same with these tiny gloves.
Stop!
And that's something we've seen from Fu in the past. When he's inside the clinch, he taps his opponent to kind of let them know that they're supposed to separate. kind of lets him know that he's in charge. He's dictating the action. It's actually an interesting mental ploy.
All right, this one does make it to the second round.
All right, looks like Liu wakes his way out of the first round after being dropped here. I think this is it right here.
It's a big replay. Big left hook there. Leads to that drop. Well timed. Look at that. He found that half beat opening. Landed a beautifully timed left hook. Put Liu right down on the ground. Deep breaths from the athlete here. I saw Liu taking some, he was actually like blinking very big. I think he was just again trying to get that those wits about him, take it back in, get his vision straightened out, if you will. But I mean, how you recover from a round like that, you know, you have to just realize that there's another round. You have to reset, you have to mentally get yourself back in action and realize there's still time for you to do something. You're not out of it, right?
You gotta keep that, how do you keep that belief inside of you after you've been dropped, after you've been hurt, if you've been dominated, you've been there, you've come back.
So you know what, I think if you have to explain it, I think that you just, you can't understand unless you're in there. I'm not really sure how to put words to that, Mitch. It's a great thing, a great question, but the attitude really is just in the mentality. It's just something different in the nature of a true competitor, a true athlete. They will never believe that they're out of it.
What separates the athletes from the champions, and you need that championship mindset, because we are sitting across, ladies and gentlemen, it is correct, we do have Miss Misha Tate calling the action. It has been our pleasure, but this matchup right now is a real showcase for Fu. He's really putting on a good performance right here, really finding his home, but one shot, one moment, and Liu can change everything.
He did taste a couple jabs there, Fu did. That's what I mean. Liu is not out of this. You know, he had 60 seconds to go back there, get some advice from his corners, and make some adjustments. But that left hook of Fu, that is the dangerous punch in this bout.
And I like his lateral movement. Look at this. Little subtle steps, left and right, constantly in one spot, never standing still.
That's the key to it, really, you know, is not to settle for too long, because that allows for timing, for range.
Nice counter right hand landed by Liu there.
Liu mixing it up a little bit here now, throwing those head kicks, throwing the leg kicks. He's definitely giving Fu more to think about. Fu trying to use the ropes as sort of a guide into that left hook. Liu was onto it though and said, I'm gonna get out of the way of dodge.
Hook landed there by Liu. That was the punch that put down Liu in the first round. As Fu landed a nice little left hook there. Now he's starting to push forward a little bit. He's got a little bit of urgency. Liu's got to do something to earn the respect of Fu, though.
Look at the damage on the inside of Liu's leg there. I didn't notice that before, but Fu has landed a few kicks there, and Liu's starting to wear a little damage. That one was a little high.
Again, he heard you. He's wanting to go back to that inside leg kick, keep touching up the leg, and it looks like he went a little bit high there. Now an athlete is allowed to 5 minutes of injury time for recovery. If we do get to a point where we're at the halfway point, I think we could be at the halfway point right now. It will go to the judges' scorecards if the athlete is unable to continue, but I don't see that in Liu. I think he's gonna be okay to push forward with the remainder of this round.
Hey!
And here we go.
See Fu going immediately back to that inside leg kick. It's all about that outside foot position, like their lead foot. It's all about who can control the outside. You can watch Fu consistently try to step to the outside of Liu's right leg just to create an opening for that straight right hand.
So interesting. Now Fu has kind of what I would describe as a martial arts style, a mixed martial arts style with the up-down movement coming in. It would be so interesting to see him transition.
Changing the levels?
Yes, to change it, because it almost looked like he was going to shoot. And I'm like, wait, this is not mixed martial arts. This is kickboxing. But way to change it up. He absolutely had Liu guessing on which direction he was going.
But those little feints, those little subtleties, that creates a reaction out of your opponent, and it can help you create a strategy for the second part of the round. And that's what was beautiful. Go catch right there. Like how he defended with the double arms.
And a big left hook to follow. Again, I think the story of this bout so far is those left hooks from Fu.
So Fu got the knockdown in the first, so that was obviously a 10-8 round going to Fu. But in the second round, that was a little bit closer.
It was closer. I give a 10-9 to Fu. I think he was able to land the more accurate strikes and mix up with his level change, especially the way that he finished that round. You know, he just kind of put that exclamation point on the round. That was a big exchange win for him.
What does Liu have to do to turn it on right now? Does he need a knockout?
Oh, look, he's shadow boxing in the corner. He's still mentally in this. You know, he may be getting slightly out technique, but he's not out of this. He's one punch away, one kick away, and that's the mindset he has to have.
Does he need the knockout?
I mean, at this point, I think he definitely could use a finish. If this was going to the judges right now, I think that he's lost, and he's lost the first two rounds. So, yes, essentially, to answer your question, in short, yes. But look at that. Just a great check right.
He's definitely got the composure. He likes to stick that jab out there. I like how he's setting up that jab, but there's nothing coming behind it.
That's because every time something comes behind it, it just seems that Fu is able to counter that. He's able to cut in on that half beat before the second punch of Liu actually lands. And that's when Liu actually gets hurt in those exchanges.
No green team, go!
See your referee Onari warning them about not to clinch.
Go, go, go!
You have 3 seconds of continuous action that you have to put forth in a clinch, otherwise the referee will break you. Good lateral movement shown by Fu as he closes the distance, throws his hands, connects with the left hand, puts together a nice little combination there.
Beautiful work. As fast as Liu is trying to move his head, he's still got stuck with a couple of those.
Yeah, it's they're just operating in different gears. Fu's just one gear ahead, just a little bit faster, a little bit quicker, throwing a little bit more volume.
Those leg kicks, too, are definitely starting to add up. You see that Liu is having to think about that now, starting to wear more and more damage on the inside leg there. And Fu definitely recognizes that. He can see that slowing the pace down of Liu.
Last round. Go!
Fu trying to feint again. There's that level change you were speaking of in the second round. You just feint there. That's creating a little. You can see the way that Liu kind of reacts and kind of flinches just to those little feints. And then after the feint, boom, there comes the low kick.
Time's up.
That one was a little bit low again. That's two. I don't believe the referee will issue a yellow card. Again, it's kind of in the flurry of the action. You can just see, I mean, he's landed that leg kick. Has to be, you know, at least a
you
dozen
know,
times.
The problem there, Mitch, is he's cutting that angle so far that when he lands that kick, the leg is bent and he's sliding up the leg into the groin because he's around the corner so far. He's actually hitting more on the front part of the thigh as opposed to the inside of the leg, and that is
nice straight left hand landed by Liu as he's trying to push forward, change the destiny. This might be surely happening right now. Nice straight right hand landed by Fu. See those angles, that movement coming from Fu. He's never in the same spot. He's always changing the angle, so it's hard for Liu to really put together anything more than one shot.
You're right, getting the timing down on someone like Fu who has such great movement, not just laterally, but up and down on his entrances. He's really so calculated. It was a great J-step.
He steps off to the left there. He lands a nice little hook inside the exchange. He was able to double up there on the left hooks.
If I was the referee, I can't say I'm so willing to jump in between these two right now.
That was a much better round for both these guys. Very entertaining round. Let's take a look at some of the action of the third and final round here of this kickboxing contest between two high-level athletes.
That was a great strike by Liu. Here we have a leg kick that leads to that left hook. Again, I feel like that was definitely the story of this competition here. Good right hand, though, just as I say that, by Fu.
And we turn it over to the judges, and it is a unanimous decision victory for Fu Qing Nan, coming away the victor in this bantamweight contest. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been a pleasure for myself and Misha Tate. We wish you the very best. We hope you have a great morning or evening wherever you are. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have another night of high stakes action coming up tomorrow at Legendary Quest. We've got champions from all over the world. We've got legends returning and new stars will be born at Legendary Quest. For myself, Mitch Chilson, and Misha Tate, thank you from everybody at One Championship.